Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Monday, June 15th, 2020, 7 p.m. meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I'm Chair Amy Scott-Gailey, and with us tonight we have Vice Chair Steve Carter, Commissioner Bill Lashley, Commissioner Eddie Boswell, and Commissioner Tim Sutton. And thank you all for coming tonight, and it's good to see everybody. So, Vice Chair Carter, would you please lead us an invocation?
Yes, indeed. Join me in prayer if you will, please. Father God, as we join here tonight, we join in a nation divided, in a community struggling to come back together as a family, dear Father. We lift up our people into Alamance County, state of North Carolina, our communities. Lift them all up to you, dear Lord, and lift us up to come together as one community and be what we need to be rightful in your sight, dear Lord, righteous. We ask, dear Lord, that you bless this meeting tonight, the deliberations we are to undertake, that our decisions will be acceptable in your sight, that the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts will be acceptable in your sight, dear Lord. We ask that you watch over us and take us home safely tonight, keep us all healthy, help us with this coronavirus that not deal with us too drastically, dear Lord. We ask, dear Lord, that you care for us as you always have. And we thank you, dear Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
If you stand and join in the pledge of allegiance, please.
Pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, the first item on our agenda is public speakers for items that are on the agenda other than the budget. We have a public hearing scheduled for the budget, which I think many of you are here for. So we have a few other items on the agenda as well. Tori, do we have anybody signed up to speak on matters not related to the budget, but if they're on the agenda? Great. Thank you. So no public speakers tonight on agenda-related items. So I presume no commissioner responses. Before I call for a motion for approval of the agenda, I'd ask you to take commissioners to take a look at the papers that you have before you. You'll notice that on the agenda we do not have a designated place for a coronavirus update from Stacey Saunders, our health director. She provided some information on for us tonight about what's going on with the virus in Alamance County. So if anybody has any questions, any commissioners have questions for Stacy, she's on phone standby tonight. And we can call Stacy and take care of that during the commissioner comments at the end of the meeting. If somebody is really important to a commissioner that they really want to have Stacy here, she could be here, or to set aside a separate agenda item for the virus, they can make a motion to amend the agenda to add that. So I just wanted to mention that before I ask if anybody is ready to make a motion for approval of the agenda as presented.
I'll make a motion to present it.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second for approval of the agenda as presented. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? And then certainly you know, if we get to commissioner comments and you have a question for Stacy Saunders, we can call her. Next item on the agenda is approval of the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second for approval of the consent agenda. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. The first item of business is the public hearing on the budget, the manager's recommended budget for fiscal year 2020-2021. First, I want to say that we were so glad that folks are here, that you took the time on a rainy Monday to come to express your thoughts about the budget. There's going to be each speaker who comes forward will get up to 5 minutes. You don't have to use your whole 5 minutes. If everybody uses the whole 5 minutes, then we can do 12 people in an hour. And I'm not sure how many people we have waiting outside, because we're limited to the number of people who could be in the room tonight because of the social distancing recommendations for the coronavirus. They're not requirements for local government under the most recent executive order. But the county felt like it was important to continue to, you know, space people out and make sure that the people who come to the meeting feel like they're safe and that they their health is being protected while they're here. So that's why attendance in the meeting room is limited. So I ask that folks refrain from applause. When you hear something you like, refrain from booing. If you hear something you do not like, because when things like that happen, it takes a little bit longer to get through the speakers, and it ends up adding up in the long term. So we have a community spirit that people are here to speak about the budget, things you like, things you don't like, but as far as the process goes, we are all in this together. So the order that I'm going to call for our speakers will be first the people who are standing in line. We have people who are waiting outside to speak, I believe. Do we know how many people we have in line? Does anybody know? If we could go ahead and let the first speakers come. So I want to wait until they're here, because our first group is going to be important, because they kind of are going to set the...
No one.
Oh, there's nobody.
Well, people signed up.
Right, I understand people have signed up, but I thought that there was not enough capacity in here, and then we have people waiting outside. Okay, well, moving forward then the people sitting inside will be the ones to go first. And this is microphone A, and this is microphone B. So when I call your name, I would ask you, the first person to speak come to microphone A, and the second person come to microphone B, and then... when a speaker finishes, I will call the next name, and they would go to the empty microphone and wait their turn, and then the person who's already present will be able to go ahead and begin their time. Clerk, do we have a list of the people who signed up, please? So I'm going to go ahead and call, well, before I do that, after we hear from the people who are sitting inside, who are present, then we also, I believe, have three residents who have asked to be able to call in to the meeting. Then we'll hear from those people over the telephone. And then last, we have people who have submitted emails that they wanted read into the record, and the clerk will do those last. And we also have a person who submitted a YouTube video as part of their public comment. And so we'll have that along with the emails. So do any of the commissioners have any questions about anything that I've said? Did I leave anything out? Okay. Then if I could have a motion to open the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to open the public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Uh-huh.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, our first speaker will be Noah Reed. Mr. Reed, if you could come to microphone A. And the second speaker is going to be Tim Woody. Mr. Woody, if you could come to microphone B and wait your turn. And then the third speaker on deck will be Trip Durham. Okay, Mr. Reed, you can begin when you're ready.
Thank you. Good evening, sir, ma'am. My name is Noah Reed, and I come as a voter and as the Secretary of the Alamance County Board of Elections. I live in Burlington, North Carolina, 2439 Glencoe Street. Last Tuesday, the bipartisan Board of Elections unanimously passed a resolution against the county manager's 45% recommended budget cuts to the Board of Elections budget. We asked that the money in the designated fund balance be put in the actual budget. If included, the designated fund balance would reduce the county manager's cuts to 35%. Last week, our Board of Elections director created a budget reduction analysis. With a 21% cut to the Board of Elections' original budget, it's the county manager, not the Board of Elections or our director, that suggests that this analysis should be part of any new budget recommendations. Because under those cuts, we would lose 100% of our funding for security carts to keep voting machines and voting supplies secure at polling sites and during transportation, computers to assist with curbside voting, state elections training this fall for the directors and staff travel to early voting sites during the upcoming election, and our Board of Elections call center. We would lose election staff funding as well. 50% cuts to part-time voting equipment technicians, 22% cuts to voting machine support staff during the election, and 11% cut to precinct workers. There are also cuts long-awaited improvements to the Board of Elections office. We should not leave our election staff to do essential work during a health crisis in a cramped office periodically subjected to sewer fumes and with undrinkable water. And we have lost experienced employees and faced hiring challenges due to the stagnating wages of the elections workers while the variety of new challenges to elections continue to grow. As the Board of Elections staff funding has remained flat for years, as the county population grows, the General Assembly passes a never-ending series of unfunded mandates, the political climate creates controversy over election administration, security costs skyrocket, and now a presidential election in the middle of a health crisis. So I ask, in these trying times, please fully fund our elections. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Reed. Mr. Woody, I think that I've called you an error, and I apologize. Now that I look at it, you're a non-agenda item.
Right.
So I apologize for asking you to step forward. Tripp Durham, are you here for the budget?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. So if you come to microphone D, please. And Sandra Jones? Is Sandra Jones here? I guess not. It looks like Butch McKenzie has signed up for a non-agenda related item. And Brian Ray, is he here? Okay. Mr. Lugo? Okay, great. Hey, how are you? Come on up to microphone A to wait your turn. And Tripp, Mr. Durham, you can start when you're ready.
Thank you. Commissioners and staff, I want to thank you for your service and for your time and your energy on behalf of Alamance County. Of the 155,000 or so that are in our county, you are the only ones that wake up every day and publicly work on our behalf. And for that, we thank you. With that, I am not here to cast any criticism tonight. I'd like to offer you a unique perspective as to the proposed reduction of funds to the Board of Elections. Through my lens, this is a question of branding and the possible continued disruption to the Alamance County brand. Through COVID-19, our county has taken a brand hit, an erosion, if you will. The New York Times has highlighted our county on our ever-rising number of corona cases. We've even had the hit from national media outlets for the situation at a speedway. So every time we turn around, seemingly, we're being hit with our brand and our image and not in a positive light. To give the country yet another reason to shame us because we did not fully fund the Board of Elections, well, I think that would be a mistake. If a budget is passed that reduces the opportunity for our citizens to be educated, to have access, and not to fully be able to exercise their full range of experiences in voting in 2020. This perceived voter suppression will be fodder for the news, or fodder yet again. From outside forces, Alamance County would be the target again for negative scrutiny, with others questioning our motives and our intentions. Now, within our cities and towns, our citizens would have cause to doubt whether or not the leadership is actually working in their best interest. And I believe this, too, would contribute to that degradation of our brand. We already are known as a conservative county, and with as much progression that we see in the rest of the country these days, the forward momentum right now being experienced, the narrative, again, of voter suppression could possibly be what is tied to our image. And I, as a branding professional and someone who's focused on image, this concerns me. Granted, I'm certainly not privy to all of the discussions that have occurred about the budget. But I do know that hope is certainly not a strategy. We can't hope that after the budget passes, that come July 1, July 2, or any time before November 2nd, that we have the funds that might be provided through Corona relief. And I certainly understand about the idea of backfilling the budget after July 1. My concern is that somebody is going to grab onto our story and beat us over the head with it. And once again, we are going to be lesser in the eyes of our nation and certainly lesser in the eyes of the citizens that we are here to serve and to work with. I ask that you give it a reconsideration, and I do thank you for your time.
Thank you.
And by the way, I'm tripped. I'm a 5'10 Fountain Place. I'm sorry I missed that one.
Thank you. Okay, Stephanie Strobel. Stephanie Strobel here. Okay. Lynn Dupree. Okay, Mr. Dupree, if you will come to microphone B. And Mr. Lugo.
Yes.
Start when you're ready.
Yes, my name is Omar Lugo. I live in Burlington. I've been a resident of Burlington for the last 2 years. And basically, he stole my speech. Now, following the same comments on what he said, the reason why I'm here is because I've seen lately a lot of attacks towards the work that you guys do, on social media, newspapers, and so forth and so on. I'm formerly a refugee from Venezuela, and for the kind of work that you guys do, you know, people over there get killed, all right? So the first thing I want to say is thank you for all the hard work that you do. I'm here just to praise on the hard work that you do, the results that we're obtaining, despite the fact that, you know, people in the nation, people in the county, you know, are criticizing, which is the most easiest thing to do. Okay, and is it funny that, you know, most of the people that I've seen criticizing the kind of work that you get, that you do, aren't here. So I just want to say thank you on behalf of my family, on behalf of the majority of people here in Alamance County. Keep up the good work, keep up the good fight. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Lynn Dupree, and I live in Gibsonville.
Can you hold on just a second, Ms. Dupree? I need to fill microphone A. Adam Rose, are you here?
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right. Is Adam Rose here? Okay, so that finishes the list of people who signed up ahead of time to speak on the budget. So I'll open up the microphone to anybody who is here who's not already signed up. If you want to be heard on the budget, you can go ahead and somebody can come and wait at microphone A. Oh, wait. Okay. Is Medora? Okay, we'll just go with Ms. Yarber. Dr. Yarber, I'm sorry. Okay, please proceed when you're ready, Ms.
Okay.
Dupree.
Lynn Dupree. I'm at 509 Meadow Street in Gibsonville. And I've lived there for the past 5 years, but I am a native North Carolinian, 11th generation North Carolinian. So I'm not a newcomer. I got an email from Thomas Lopez, who is the executive director for Democracy North Carolina, and he sent out an email telling me about this meeting. So thank you and for inviting the public to speak. And I got a phone call too, so things are revving up. This is a very important election. And since the county commissioners are also elected officials, you're aware of the importance of free and fair elections. That is the very bedrock of our country, of everything that we're about, is elections. So before you fund anything else, elections. That has to be number one. And I wanted to just point out especially some special needs that people have. I'm a senior, and seniors need extra help to vote. Just because we're seniors doesn't mean that we're less important. You know, we paid our taxes, we worked our whole life, now a lot of us are retired. We still need to be able to vote, and our votes need to count. So with the COVID now, seniors are most in danger of catching that. And so, you know, I'm asking you to fund whatever you need to fund in order to make that happen so that it's safe for everybody. Seniors can't stand in line, and we've seen the pictures of what just happened in another state where people standing in line for 8 hours. And so a lot of seniors can't drive. We have to depend on public transportation, or we have to have a helper to help us drive. And I was just reading, I saw that Governor Cooper signed House Bill 1169 into law. So the funding is there, the money's there. And I know y'all are gonna have to finagle things around, however you do that. That's wonderful. I'm glad that you're here to serve and to do that. So in closing, I'm just asking you to pay attention to this election and to be aware that this is the most important election probably in our lifetimes. Whichever side you're on, you'll agree to that. So thank you for hearing my comments.
Thank you. Before Dr. Yarbrough starts, is Medora Burke Fall here? Thank you. Come on to microphone B, and Dr. Yarbrough, whenever you're ready.
Oh, thank you, commissioners, and good evening. I'm Dorothy Yarbrough, 331 Woodhaven Drive of Burlington, and I'm also a member of the Board of Elections. Now, I'm not going to repeat what the secretary, I think Noah Reed did an excellent job. What I would like to say is that the budget that the Board of Elections presented, we didn't know about COVID. We didn't know what was going to happen with COVID, so that is not included in that particular budget. So what we're asking is that we fund the budget, because our executive director, Kathy Holland, is going to do the very best she can to work with the budget that we submitted. She is following the dictates from the State Board of Elections. Right now, they are asking that we have our voting sites in buildings where you can go in one door and out the other. Now, we have at least 37 precincts, so we don't know if we're going to be in the same spots. We don't know who's going to be able to clean those buildings. So, but those funds are not in that particular budget. So we're going to have to work with what the budget that we have asked for. Also, we know that the majority of the people who work at the polls are senior citizens. Some of them have already said, I will not be able to work at the polls this year. We don't know if we're going to be able to get anyone to replace them. We don't know if we'll be able to get people to place them with the salary that we're already giving them. But we are willing to work with the budget that we have requested. Rather than to keep coming back. So our executive director is working hard to look for places, because we don't know who's going to clean. Do we have to have additional people to come behind and clean all of the machines? We certainly know we're going to have them cleaned at the end of the evening. So if we are able to at least fund what we've asked for, we are going to try to work with that. And have that amount of money in our budget. Thank you.
Thank you. Is Jennifer Warren here? If you want to come to microphone A, and you may proceed when you're ready.
Hi, my name is Medora Burke School. I live at 3673 Mebane Routers Road in Mebane. Firstly, I just want to say thank you for allowing the public to come out and have a voice in this decision. Voting is a right afforded by our Constitution, and I'm sure I know several of you could quote that thing to me. It's the foundation of our democracy, and so I just wanted to come up and stand up and say that I'm asking you to consider the safety of poll workers when you vote on this budget. I vote in Haw River, and having voted there for years, I can tell you that polling staff are not exactly spring chickens. I suppose the politically correct way to say that is that my polling site is staffed almost entirely by senior citizens. My mom is a poll worker where I grew up in Wisconsin, and her polling site, I don't know if you guys watched the news about what happened in the Wisconsin primary, but it got pretty political and it got pretty ugly, and a lot of the poll workers, like 19 poll workers, wound up probably being exposed and contracting COVID-19, being out there supporting people's political right and constitutional right to vote. Alamance County hasn't had good press lately. I think you guys will agree that we've taken a black eye on the national stage, and it's embarrassing. Like, I love my county, and I want us to shine brightly, and it would really be a shame to see what happened in Georgia with people standing in the rain for 6-8 hours and just turning away and not being able to exercise their right to happen here in Alamance County. You know that the press would have a field day with that. They'd be talking about voter suppression. I understand that you guys have a really hard set of choices to make. Normally I'm up here stumping for the ABSS budget, but you guys thankfully didn't gut our budget this time. So I want to say thank you for that. But I do need you to re-examine 54%, I think is what I read, proposed cut in the elections budget. People shouldn't have to choose between exercising their constitutional right to vote and going somewhere unsafe where they could potentially contract a virus and die. That's an unfair choice to ask people to make. So I hope that you guys consider fully funding the election and making sure that there's enough polling places and enough polling workers to make sure that people can vote safely and equitably in this county. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Before you start, does that call Adam Rose? I didn't mark it up on the list. I want to be sure that I didn't skip him. Okay, anybody who wants to come to microphone B, it's available. And go ahead and start when you're ready.
Okay, so I'm here for a little bit different situation with the budget. The election is important, and you know, we always need that. I'm here as a mother and a coach and part of the Alamance Burlington School System staff. I received a call this past week that they're looking at a $122,000 budget cut in our Rec and Parks Department. It will cut Special Olympics, our youth sports, the library funding, all kinds of things. And these things are so important with our kids. I mean, I see it in the classrooms all the time that these kids need positive people in their lives. They do. And I know we're worried about, you know, other things in this world and the ACUA thing and all this, but our kids are so important. I have kids that come out on my field. My husband and I have been coaching at Hallfield Civitans for 5 or 6 years now. And we started with our kids in T-ball, and now we've at baseball and softball levels and football teams. We coach in a wide variety of areas. My son cried when he thought that there would be no football this year. It's just that important to him. And it's not just the game. It's the community. It's the friends that we have developed. And I've got two kids that are on our team, and my son swears they're his stepbrothers, and I've only been married once and only plan to be married once. But just that bond that they drive, and it's not one aspect of life. It goes all the way through. Some of my greatest coaches have driven me to be here. Just the heart that they gave me to protect sports and to just keep that value. Coach Moon is one of our deputies here in Alamance County, and he was the athletic director when I was at Eastern. I'm like telling my age saying that. But it's been all through my life. My dad's coached me. My friend's dad's coached me. And I stand on the basis that coachable kids become employable adults. And that's not just sports. I mean, that's all around, whether it's checkers or debate teams or anything. These team sports are so important to our kids. And then our special athletes, like, I don't even know how you go into that. It's just all around important. It combats obesity. It's keeping them involved in the community. It's everything. Our seniors, my grandmother lives for her, senior bingo out at Pleasant Grove. I mean, I love it. But I just ask you not to cut the budget that harshly. I don't know what the solution is. Maybe it's get Amazon to pay us our sales tax if they need to be taken out of everything that I order from Amazon. I don't know. But, you know, I feel like that there's something we can do to protect our kids. They're so important, and they're the next generation. They're the next one of you guys working as a team to develop things. The sheriff's department, all these things are based off of team players, and we have to learn to work together. And that's just what I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? The microphone is available. No? See people who are here who haven't spoken enough.
Just
came for the
spectators.
The spectators. Okay, well then we'll move on to the call-ins. We have a couple of people, two people who had asked for us to call them tonight. So the clerk will call them.
Hello,
Mr. Coleman.
Yes.
Okay, you're connected to the county commissioner's meeting.
How you doing?
Hey, Mr. Coleman, how are you? This is Amy Gailey. You ready to do your public comment?
Yeah, can you hear me?
We can. Go ahead and get started whenever you're ready.
Okay, first of all, I just want to thank you guys for this call. You know, as I get older, it's a little bit harder to get around, so the call was just right for me. Thank you very much. You probably know the reason I wanted to be on the agenda tonight. I have a real concern about the Recreation Department cuts in the budget. I understand that their budget will be cut by $122,739. This cut will eliminate, and I mean all, youth athletic programs, senior citizen programs, programs for the visually impaired. It also includes the county's participation in Special Olympics. I just think this is extreme, and it's all a huge mistake, in my opinion. And I'll give you, for instance, kids start playing sports as young as 6 years old. Kids of all races come together to enjoy wholesome activities, not to mention needed exercise. Parents and grandparents are brought together in a family atmosphere, and we certainly need togetherness in this world today, that's for sure. Now, you know, recreation activities certainly keep our children out of trouble and prepare them for adulthood. Now, communities outside of municipalities such as Pleasant Grove, AO, Alexander Wilson, Eli Whitney, E.M. Holt, Sylvan in the Snow Camp area, Union Ridge, Sackville, Pleasant Hill, Clover Garden, Sweptonville, and the Elon area can no longer depend on the County Recreation and Parks Department for these programs. And this is pretty sad. But anyway, as I mentioned before, the county will no longer participate in Special Olympics. How about these Olympians? What will happen to them? Will this program disappear? Now, this is not good, that's for sure, if you've ever seen Special Olympic Games. Now, and I know the virus will dictate to all of us what and when these programs will open up again. However, when things do get better, and I'm sure they will, and the sales tax comes in more than expected, I heard 20% or better, it is my hope that these funds will be restored and all recreation park programs will continue. And just please remember, folks, our youth and our special population folks are our future. And I thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Coleman. The next person. Go ahead.
Good. Good night.
All right, good night. Thank you. Clark, you want to call the next person?
This will be Barbara. Mayor?
Yes, Victoria.
You're connected to the county commissioners meeting.
Okay, can you hear me okay?
Yes.
We can hear you, Bob. This is Amy. You can start your comment whenever you're ready.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, commissioners. And yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Are you all right?
Can you hear me now?
I can.
Okay, well.
You might want to turn off whatever it is. Okay. If you've got a feed going, if you're listening to it.
Hello, everybody. Hello, commissioners. I really appreciate your service and appreciate you taking my call. As you know, I'm a former Alamance County Commissioner, and having been through the county's budget process four times as a commissioner, I appreciate how hard it is to come up with a budget that balances our community's values, needs, and priorities with the funding that is available. And I appreciate and agree with your current position that now is not a good time to consider a property tax increase to make up for the reduction in sales tax revenue, as many people in our community are hurting. They have lost their jobs and income due to the COVID-19 pandemic. While serving my term as a commissioner, I developed great respect for our Board of Elections Director, Kathy Holland, and know firsthand her dedication to the people of this county and her commitment to ensuring a fair and thorough elections process for every election, as well as her ability to create a budget that is frugal but effective. I personally know pretty well four out of the five members of the Board of Elections, and I know that the entire board operates in a bipartisan, should I say, nonpartisan way to ensure that our elections are fair for all. That said, I know that elections are of the highest importance because they are fundamental to our democracy, the essence of our way of living. I know that this election year is different. It's a presidential election year. More voters are being registered as our population increases. We're in a pandemic that's requiring special measures. More people will be voting by mail. All these things require increased funding. And that is what our Board of Elections has requested. I know that our county manager, Brian Davis, for whom I have the utmost respect, has done a masterful job at being creative under circumstances at finding the funding for meeting the budget request of the Board of Elections. It's just that he didn't find all of it in the general fund. He found some of it in a couple of designated funds and in some in COVID-19 grants and allocations. So I would respectfully ask the Board of Commissioners, if at all possible, to include these non-general fund sources of revenue in the elections budget. If that can't be done, say through some taxpayers, then I would respectfully request that the board pass a resolution that would obligate the county to allocate the appropriate designated funds and the COVID-19 funds to the elections process. Because it is so important that our elections director has access now to all the resources she needs to carry out an elections process that begins only 4 months from now with early voting for the November election. So I thank you for receiving my comments, and I thank you for your consideration.
All right, thank you. The next public comments that we'll hear, or public hearing comments that we'll hear, will be the emails. And so the clerk will read those. And we do have, let's see the video one first. So we have somebody who emailed us a video, and we've never done this before. This is unusual. And I think that we don't have a rule against it, so we're going to do it. But I think that we might consider amending the rules of procedure, or the board's rules, at some point, because we don't know what's always going to be on a video before we see it. And we can't discriminate on content, and the presentation of some videos might be odd. But this is a good one, I heard. So go ahead.
Madam Chair, and members of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, thank you for the opportunity to come before you. My name is Barrett Brown, president of the local NAACP. I believe the county manager's proposed budget cuts to the County Board of Elections are excessive, and I would like to register the concerns of the members of the NAACP. We are concerned that Mr. Hager's proposed cuts would severely disable the Board of Elections from carrying out the functions that would provide access to the ballot and the security of the voting process. We do not want to lose weekend voting hours or early voting sites because of a lack of funding. We are concerned that there will not be enough money to pay the non-permanent employees, which would cause major problems processing voters at the polls and at the Board of Elections office. We are concerned of cuts to funds that provide for voting equipment and maintenance and secure storage. We also oppose the withholding of funds from the Board of Elections. If the funds are allocated for the executive director, she should have access to them. She should not have to keep coming before the county commissioners, hat in hand, to appeal for funds to run an election in a manner mandated by the state. Those of us calling for peace and unity in the aftermath of the murder of George Floyd are telling people that their energies are best served by voting. Not fully funding the elections will undermine that good faith. Access to the ballot is not a luxury. In these turbulent times, we should not be diminishing access to a secure ballot process. We should be expanding it. The NAACP opposes voter suppression and opposes the county manager's budget as currently proposed. We believe this proposed budget is severely lacking in necessary funds. Underfunding the voting process undermines our democracy. Thank you very much for your time.
Did he say in the video, can you give his name?
Yeah.
I know it's Barrett Brown, but I didn't know if he said it. Okay.
Yeah, he said it.
Okay. That was a good video. Impressive. Okay, so you want to read the emails that we received, please?
First up, dear Chair Gailey and Board of Commissioners, in Alamance Burlington Schools, we take seriously our role in supporting the collective success of our community. Alamance County taxpayers are our partners in this important work, as our public schools provide critical infrastructure in our community. Citizens and trust educators with laying the foundation and helping design a solid framework to enable students to succeed, ultimately improving our community's long-range prosperity. Our students' achievements today will yield dividends for everyone's tomorrow. Meeting the academic, health, and social emotional needs of 23,000 students in our care is our priority. We invest financial resources and professional expertise in best practices designed to meet every student where they are so that we can help each student achieve his or her personal best. As we are successful in meeting goals, our community benefits from its collective investment in Alamance County students. In today's stressful climate, schools are more important than ever that we work together to meet the needs of our community. Teachers and schools represent stability, routine, and a sense of normal, a cornerstone for helping children feel as safe, secure, and calm as possible during these unprecedented times. We are proud of their efforts and our collective response to recent challenges. We are in this together. We recognize that Alamance County will continue to experience adverse impacts and increased needs for some time to come. Lower than projected sales tax revenue as businesses struggle to return to their pre-shutdown schedule, combined with critical needs and other civic services, will mean that important priorities in our schools will have to be postponed. To make up for a proposed funding decrease from county funds, Alamance Burlington Schools is working to meet mandatory budget increases in our critical obligations with a combination of one-time federal and state allocations, as well as prioritization of existing funds based on changing needs related to the pandemic. While our priorities and needs remain, we are committed to doing our part to meet our district's basic needs with the county manager's recommended budget allocation for ADSS. We support Mr. Haven's budget proposal presented for approval this evening. Sincerely, Allison Gann, Chair, Board of Education, and W.B. Bruce Benson, Superintendent. Next, we have a form email that was submitted by Mary Thomas, Carlos Rivera, Hannah Thomas, Christina Terrain, Zach Clemens, Sheila Graham, Imani Vaughn, Daniel Santana, and America Lopez. It says, I demand the Alamance County Board of Commissioners to vote no on the proposed 2021 fiscal budget on Monday, 6/15, in response to the ongoing epidemic of police brutality and for the inherent systemic racism of the police system itself. As a result of COVID-19 pandemic, the Alamance County budget is $4.3 million less than the current annual budget. The reduction will be felt by all county services. However, under the proposed budget, its impact will not be felt equitably or justly. The public safety function budget will decrease by 0.3% compared to the original fiscal year 2020 budget. With this reduction, public safety would remain the second largest function within the general fund by expenditure with a budget of $39,338,443. I urge the Alamance County Board of Commissioners towards an ethical and equal reallocation of the Alamance expense budget away from the most funded division of public safety. The proposed $12.5 million Sheriff's Office budget is partially intended to fund 12 new patrol vehicles with equipment. Our county does not need new police vehicles. We need economic growth, improved school resources, and more social services to address the cause of crime at the root. The economic and physical development function budget has a proposed budget of $3.6 million, a 17.81% decrease from the current annual budget. The funds for this function could be used in investing in economic opportunity, encouraging business development, innovation, and supporting small businesses as our county recovers from the pandemic. The Alamance-Burlington School System proposed budget will decrease by 6% from its current budget. The $121,320 for three new patrol vehicles would fund approximately three yearly teacher salaries. The money could be used to replace old technology, textbooks, and infrastructure within ABSS. I demand my tax dollars be put towards health and human services, libraries, and education programs, as well as economic and physical development, effective at the beginning of fiscal year 2021. We have Ben Masters, 509 Norwood Street, Southwest Lenore. I believe cutting that much money and lessening people's chances of being able to vote is a violation of our freedom of speech. We need to be able to vote, and if we are hindered, then democracy as we know it collapses. Please do not disenfranchise people further. We need fair voting, and the only way to do that is through money. Brian Pennington, 712 West Davis, Burlington. It is critical that we do not cut funding to the Board of Elections in this election year, when there are already so many challenges to the ability of people to vote. We must retain multiple early voting sites and ensure the security of our votes, when we are all certain that foreign actors are trying to undermine our confidence in the integrity of our elections. voter education and nonpartisan get out the vote efforts are crucial. Do not cut this funding. Next we have Dave Sherwell, 1504 West Front Street, Burlington. It is my understanding that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners is considering cutting hundreds of thousands of dollars from the Board of Elections budget this year. I strongly oppose this proposal. This is the worst possible time to be cutting back on the security and accessibility of our voting rights. I hope you will choose to fully fund the Board of Elections so as to ensure that voting this year goes smoothly and safely so that all citizens will feel confident that their opinions count. Thank you. Demetri McKinney, 3836 Stony Creek Church Road. As a college student, in an early voting site is the only place I get to vote when I come home from Raleigh at election time. By closing early voting sites, it will make voting in person essentially inaccessible to me, let alone the hundreds of others who need early voting because of their inability to go vote come election day. Beyond the premise of physically casting a ballot at a polling place, I am also very deeply troubled at how this may affect our immunocompromised citizens who will need the option to vote by mail or at least have a polling place that is stringently sanitized. By cutting the number of polling workers, we're cutting our ability to make sure that voting is safe for everyone. I say this as someone who has to run through the daily calculations of risk when it comes to activities outside of the home because of a personal relationship with a compromised immune system. Furthermore, cutting funds to ensure that our ballots are secure is a way that all too easily can discredit hundreds of votes. To add to that, by allowing even the slightest amount of doubt related to the means by which we cast our votes completely, delegitimizes the democratic process. This is not something to be confused with. The voters' ID argument for North Carolina has a track record with having issues with voting machines. There is a history of widespread issues, and ignoring the issues is negligent. To return to the issue of closing polling places, I would like to turn your attention to the concept of voter disenfranchisement. By limiting the citizens' ability to vote, you disenfranchise them from the process that is rightfully theirs. For many, early voting is their only option because that is the only time when they can get off work or get a ride to the polling place, or the line is short enough for them to vote without penalty at work because election day is not a holiday. In a time when the whole nation is discussing the importance of everyone to be involved in our processes, cutting the budget of our Board of Elections seems at best tone deaf and at worst malicious. I say that we should as a community be bending over backwards to make voting more accessible to all instead of throwing up barriers to all who want to vote. Kevin Agnew, 117 Parker Street, Burlington. Article 6 of the North Carolina Constitution provides residents the right to vote. I strongly object to the 35% proposed reduction of the Alamance County Board of Elections in the 2021 budget. This massive reduction in the proposed budget infringes on the rights of all Alamance County residents by reducing the resources necessary to hold secure, efficient, timely, free, and fair elections and is a threat to our democracy. Fox News reported on May 15th that Bill Ivania, the Senate confirmed director of the National Counterintelligence and Security Center, U.S. elections are the foundation of our nation's democracy. the Senate Intelligence Committee report on election interference started stated that they found the direct extensive activity against U.S. election infrastructure. The 2016-17 approved Alamance County budget appropriated $850,000 to elections and $880,000 for the 2017-18 budget. The threat to our democracy has diminished since that time, and we must ensure that Alamance County has done everything in its power to ensure our Board of Elections has the necessary resources to facilitate our election and provide results that represent our beloved residents accurately and completely. The proposed budget cuts to the Board of Elections undermines our election process and our county country's democracy. I demand that the Board of Elections be given the full resources they propose so that the American people may have faith in our government and that we can ensure our country remains the great country that our founders intended. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. Next, we have Maureen Peeler of 552 Carlton Avenue. Board of Election budget cuts proposed by the county manager at last Monday's county commissioner meeting would be catastrophic. The county manager called for budget cuts of close to $725,000 to the Board of Elections budget for this year. We would likely lose all but the Graham early voting site. Weekend voting hours would be cut by half. The non-permanent employee salary cuts would cause major problems processing voters at the polls and at the Board of Elections office. There would be cuts to funds for voting equipment, maintenance and storage, and to computer leases. Security for voting equipment storage sites and cybersecurity would be both compromised. Printing for paper ballots and other election needs would be incredibly underfunded. Advertisement, voter education would be cut dramatically. No funding for COVID prep at election sites or the coming surge and processing expenses for absentee ballots is even included. Paula Harrison, 102 Alyssa Drive. Now is not the time to make budget cuts to the Board of Elections budget. The money as requested is needed to make sure all Alamance County residents can vote in this election. Yes, Sam Cryan, 1106 Apoc Avenue, Burlington. With the uncertainty surrounding the elections this year from coronavirus, it is more important than ever that we invest in the proper infrastructure to make sure people are able to vote. We need the full election fund to be able to adapt to whatever life throws at us next and make sure that Alamance's voice is heard when we vote this November. Emily Slaves of Burlington, please do not cut $725,000 from the elections budget. Elections will likely be altered due to COVID-19. Therefore, we must have full funding in order to ensure a safe, fair, and honest election. Emma Picker, 9271 Perry Road, Graham. Please, for the sake of democracy and the health of our people, reconsider the budget cuts to many of the measures put into place to increase voter turnout and accessibility. Early voting, mail-in ballots, and measures to assist in COVID-safe voting in helping democracy stay alive during these unprecedented times. Please, for the health and safety of the county and of democracy, reconsider the budget proposal. Ashley McKenna, 2885 South 3rd Street Extension. More money for ABSS, no budget cuts for Board of Elections, and less money for the County Sheriff's Department. We have Maura Marquise, 2051 Davis Road. I urge you to advocate for a meaningful reallocation of the county's expenditures away from policing and towards social programs and resources that support housing, jobs, education, health care, and other critical community needs. In 2019, Alamance County spent 7% of our county's budget on the sheriff's office, with another 7% going to the jail. In contrast, our schools have 26% of the budget, and we have one of the worst performing school districts in North Carolina. The local community college receives only 2% of our budget. Students have to take out loans in order to attend, and adjunct faculty get paid $2,000 to teach a class. We are a rural community. Our investment should be in uplifting people through education, not punishing people for poverty. In the proposed budget 2021, the public safety budget is 23%, almost doubling what it is now. Although we all want to live in a safe place, the best way to guarantee our safety is to provide people with skills, health care, housing, and food. Our local tax dollars should be going towards promoting community safety through investing in our children, education, and health and well-being. Harry Griffin, 1745 NC Highway 49. Today, I am requesting that the commissioners consider decreasing the amount of funds allocated to public safety, including the sheriff's office, school resource officers, and jail. By doing so, Alamance County can more sufficiently fund areas in our community that will improve overall economic growth, support, education, and increase social services for rehabilitation. In the current proposal, the education budget is 6% less than it was last year, while the public safety budget is nearly flat to last year. Please vote no on the county manager's proposed budget for the 21 fiscal year. Please advise the proposed budget decreasing public safety funding and increasing education and human services funding. Please consider reinvesting this money in the county's Black communities, which house people who are most affected by policing and criminalization. Jennifer McGowan of Burlington. It is ridiculous that our kids' sports programs are on the chopping block. These kids need this not only for exercise, but for learning about sport and sportsmanship. Now more than ever, they need to learn how to work together. Funny how kids are first up on the chopping block. Where's the money we already paid for the spring sports that didn't happen? Why not cut some of the things that aren't pertinent? Sports is important. For some kids, that is all they have. Next up, we have Michael Graves of Burlington. Dear County Manager and County Commissioners, I am writing to express my concern for the budget for the Board of Elections. I am concerned that the budget has been cut by 53%, roughly $700,000 less than the budget approved amount for the last fiscal year. The thing that sets us apart from any other nation in the world that the brings insecure elections, which I think would be in jeopardy with such a drastic cut in the budget. I believe that this cut would be drastic at any time, but especially with the upcoming national election, along with the COVID-19 standards that must be adhered to which is mandated by the state. This, in my opinion, will put a free and secure elections at risk if we do not have the resources to make sure the elections are secure. What puts us above every other nation in history is our republic, which is voted on by the people, is secure. I believe the long lines that we have seen in places like Ohio, Wisconsin, and just as recently as Georgia will be the outcome of the budget cuts here in Alamance County. When people cannot trust our elections, that's when our republic is at risk and becomes fragile. I understand the downturn of the economy as a result of the COVID-19 virus has put resources locally in a shortfall, and I do not envy the tough choices the county manager and the board has to make, but I would ask you to please reconsider the budget cuts and heed the words of one of our most revered forefathers and patriots, Benjamin Franklin. When asked, "What have you given us, Mr. Franklin?" And he replied back, "A government, and to keep it, as Benjamin Franklin said, we must be able to have free and secure elections. Please reconsider your decision and make sure every citizen in Alamance County is confident that they have voted in a free and secure election and their vote will be counted as it was cast. Thank you for your time and consideration in this most important matter. Very best regards, Michael Graves." Sally Ernest of 3814 Asbury Court, Burlington. "It is vital that the Board of Elections be fully funded so that we can have a fair election with absentee ballots being available to all who need them and all polling places open as possible in the midst of the COVID pandemic. Thank you." Thomas Lane, 8710 Mandel Road, Graham. "I understand that this year's budget is significantly impacted by COVID-19 and the associated decline in the collected tax revenue. However, I am extremely concerned that the proposed budget for the Board of Elections is woefully underfunded, specifically slashing the operating cost to $100,000 from the proposed amount of $628,659. Seems to be very questionable. The election in November could very likely have the highest voter turnout in history. I do not see how the Board of Elections can possibly provide a sufficient amount of polling places and voting support for Alamance County citizens while functioning with operating costs that are only around 1/6 of the proposed funding amount. In 2017-18, an off-cycle year when the county had fewer residents, the Board of Elections operating costs were $261,308, more than twice the current proposed amount. It is critical that the county works to protect the integrity of our voting process so we do not repeat the mistakes made by certain counties in Georgia, Texas, and other states that have recently provided an insufficient number of polling locations and voting machines, which resulted in ridiculously long lines and created chaos on voting day. I urge you to increase the operating cost for the BOE so that our county can maintain the integrity of the voting process. I also urge the county to extend the early voting period and increase the number of locations where Alamance County residents can vote early. Thank you very much for your consideration." Mm-hmm. 3844 Heritage Drive. Please fund the Board of Elections fully in the 2021 budget. Your charge is to fund the elections adequately. With the anticipated increase in absentee balance, the Board of Elections will need to be fully funded in order to make for safe and secure elections. Do not rely upon funding from outside sources. This funding is not guaranteed. If it does not come through our county elections, could be in jeopardy. Please take your responsibility to provide accurate elections, which is the backbone of our democracy. Homer Ashby Jr. We have Ricardo Morales, 626 Hollow Street, Graham. Budget proposal. Voting is a right that we all have. It's a budget that cannot be cut because there isn't enough money. There is enough money, we just have to redistribute funds. How can you decrease the public safety budget only 0.29% compared to the previous budget and believe it's okay to cut Board of Elections budget by around 52% in an election year? How can you all have Zoom meetings or any other online meetings and believe it's okay to cut the budget that will provide less money for mail-in ballots or the employees risking their lives for the people? The more voting locations, the more available times means people can still vote and not expose themselves to as many people because they won't be standing in a just one or few lines full of people. You should be ashamed for even proposing this budget cut. Don't ever call yourself a civil servant if you aren't looking after the right for your citizens who love Graham and Alamance. They have the health and safety and access to vote. Do better, Graham. Next, we have John Coleman of 817 Kenwood Drive. Dear Chair Galey and County Commissioners alike, I write to you today as a concerned citizen about some of the proposed cuts in the upcoming budget for 2021. It is deeply concerning that the county has decided to cut out the funding for all county rec-sponsored sports programs, baseball, boys, girls, basketball, softball, football. Youth sports are essential to the youth of this county and their development during their growing year. Allowing children to play in outdoor extracurricular activities such as sports helps children develop skills which are beneficial throughout their lives. By playing sports, children are exposed to various mental, social, emotional, physical, and educational benefits. Sports for youth help develop self-esteem and confidence. It also introduces the child to constructive criticism, which is essential to building character. They also allow for children to develop social skills. It allows them to interact with other children from different backgrounds and make friends along the way. With more friendship circles, the child will learn communication skills which will help them in the future. Careers and relationships. Sports also introduces the child to the ability to accept defeat. It is a given that you will not always win them all. However, sports introduces children perseverance and getting up and trying again after a defeat. Sports also helps your children learn to maintain discipline. By listening to instructions from your coaches and peers for good discipline and bad discipline, your child will learn another skill which will help them throughout their lives. Finally, the most important skill a child will learn is teamwork. There is no I in team. Sports provide children with a unique opportunity to work as a team, to achieve a common goal. By working together, children learn their teammates' and friends' strengths and weaknesses, which help strategize a winning environment. This will, without a doubt, help our children in the future with their careers and relationships as well. In closing, I feel that these skills are essential to our youth of Alamance County. They have already had to suffer through so much during the past year when it comes to the pandemic. They missed out of sports, going to school, hanging with friends, and just being able to be a kid. We should not punish our children further by taking away all their sports for the upcoming year. We have too many top-tier coaches and parents that are true leaders of men and women of our youth, and they deserve to be able to play and be with their friends. And Mr. Coleman also submitted a petition that is at your seat. George Adams, 317 Beacon Drive, Burlington. Mr. and Mrs. Commissioner, I hope you haven't forgotten that working people and the retired are still facing unknown circumstances in the future. Governor Cooper is still trying to shut down anything he can, and still the COVID is all around us with the state. About to give all the student-less teachers a 2.5% raise and a bonus. Government workers are compensated far and above your ordinary citizens. Well, maybe the demonstrations will cause some equity when pigs fly. Trisha Aspie, 3844 Heritage Drive. Dear Chairman Gailey and other commissioners, I am distressed by the thought of you cutting the budget for the Board of Elections at a time when, in order to have a fair and valid election on November the 3rd, 2020, we need to increase the resources available to the Board of Elections. Have you not heard that we are in the middle of a deadly global pandemic that is certain to still be raging on November the 3rd? Have you not observed, ever since his inauguration, Donald Trump's multiple attempts to suppress the vote of people who he fears will oppose his re-election, falsely claiming that election fraud is widespread and falsely claiming that absentee voting leads to increased fraud? If anything, for the November 3rd election, we need an infusion of extra funding to guarantee that the election conducted in North Carolina will give everyone, regardless of political party, socioeconomic status, race, age, zip code, or any other demographic, equal opportunity to vote and to have their vote counted without having to stand in line for an unreasonable length of time and without any voter having to choose between voting and the risk of getting COVID-19 coronavirus. As elected officials for Alamance County, it is your responsibility to be sure that the aforementioned conditions and goals are achieved and that whatever money is needed for the Board of Elections to achieve them is available. Thank you for your attention to this matter.
Safer and better place.
2020 is a presidential election year, and that election will be taking place in the context of a pandemic, which will certainly alter voting patterns and require our Board of Elections to be flexible. They will need funding to accommodate increased absentee ballot requests, greater early voting hours, so that social distancing system may be maintained, and other accommodations for public safety. How is the board supposed to make these changes in a presidential election with a higher anticipated voter turnout than the past 2 years, with a tighter budget than that of a year when the most significant elections were at the municipal level? This pandemic is not the only reason that I feel the Board of Elections budget should not be cut. However, last week, Governor Cooper signed House Bill 1159 into law, expanding absentee ballot access in light of the pandemic. When I called the Board of Elections today to inquire about that new access, specifically the email address to which absentee ballot request forms could be sent, the board was not aware of this new legislation, and the representative told me that, to the best of her knowledge, no such law had been passed yet. I had to confirm with the North Carolina Board of Elections that House Bill 1159 had passed and allowed absentee ballot request forms to be turned in via email. I didn't mind having to do this, but other voters who have less time or access to accurate information may be confused, disillusioned, or simply unmotivated to pursue accurate information to this degree, and they shouldn't have to. The Board of Elections should have adequate funding and staffing to keep up to date with state level developments and disseminate that information to Alamance County voters. I am extremely concerned about Alamance County voters being unable to receive accurate and up-to-date information about this important upcoming election. And I anticipate that reducing the Board of Elections budget will only exacerbate these problems. I implore you to reconsider the funding for the Board of Elections and instead fully fund their request for the 2021 fiscal year. Colin Cannon, 717 South 5th Street. I appreciate the commissioner's difficult position regarding budgeting for the year. Cuts and freezes are clearly necessary. As a resident and a voter, I am concerned about the upcoming November election. The early voting site issue is less important to me than the smooth operation of absentee ballot by mail, which I expect will be drastically increased over last year. Please ensure that Alamance County Board of Elections has adequate funding to process a much higher number of mail-in ballots in a timely fashion. It will be very embarrassing for the county if mail-in ballots are not sent to those who request them or are not processed after the election for many weeks due to budget shortfalls. Adequate funding of boards of elections is one of the basic duties of government in a democracy. The machinery of voting is how the commission's constituents keep it accountable, and sharp cuts to the funding of this machinery strikes at the very legitimacy of the commission's authority. Please demonstrate that the commission respects its citizens by preserving their free exercise of this fundamental right. We have Dustin Collins, 381 Stone Road. It has been brought to my attention that the Alamance County Recreation Sports of football and basketball are being talked about getting canceled this upcoming year. I have been coaching baseball and basketball for the community for 8 to 10 years now. It would devastate kids to not be able to play sports. Also, kids playing sports keeps them active and not on electronic devices all the time. There is a lot of people in Alamance County that would do fundraisers to help raise money for the community for these kids to be able to play the sport they love. If at all possible, cutting something else, maybe instead of hurting these kids. They are our future, and you're only a kid once. If fundraisers will help, I would be glad to spread the word and help in any way possible. My grandfather helped kids his whole life, and I cherish doing the same. The bridge at Saxville Hall is named in honor for the work he put forth in Alamance County. Please consider these kids and not canceling their dreams, if at all possible. Thank you very much for your time and cooperation. Justin Collins. Jackie Lanning of 1826 Hanford Hills Road, Graham. My name is Jackie Lanning and I am a resident of Alamance County. I stand with 275 people who care and are concerned about the future of Alamance County in response to a proposed budget for the year 2021. We urge the county commissioners to vote no on the proposed budget and to fund the sheriff's budget. In the middle of a global pandemic, our nation is being called to address the widespread epidemic of police brutality and the inherent systemic racism of the police system itself. Our communities are in need of visionary leadership to take action in solidarity with our Black community and everyone who stands for anti-racism. We the people of Alamance County call the Alamance County Board of Commissioners to become these visionary leaders by pledging to defund the Alamance County Sheriff's Office and invest in resources that directly benefit and support the lives in our Black and Brown communities. We call on them to commit the following by Tuesday, June 30th, to vote no on county manager's proposed budget for the fiscal 2021 year, to immediately revise the 2021 fiscal year budget to decrease the proposed budget for the Sheriff's Office, to reinvest in the county's Black communities, which house people who are the most affected by police brutality, to protect and expand current investment in community-led health and safety strategies instead of investing in police. Decrease future sheriff's office spending and reinvest in economic growth, health care, education, public transportation, and voting accessibility. We will not continue to be silent on issues that directly affect the communities of our Black brothers and sisters. We urge the county commissioners to stand in solidarity along with us, the people of Alamance County. We will continue this fight until we have a system that prioritizes education and rehabilitation. And Madam Chair, that is all of the public comments that came through our public comments form.
Thank you. Very nice job reading all of that. Do you want to touch some water? Yes. Okay. All right. Thank you very much, Madam Clerk. All right. That being all the persons who want to be heard at the public hearing on the manager's recommended budget, I would entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second, a third and a fourth to close the public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right, so we're into the discussion and possible adoption of the budget ordinance. I think Mr. Haygood has some things prepared. If commissioners want to hear them, I was going to throw it out to the commissioners just for discussion. I know that Mr. Sutton likes to be heard.
Since when?
So, what's the pleasure of the board? Would you like for Mr. Haygood to?
Well, I'd like to ask him a question he might address while he's talking. I do want to know what the difference, and I'm sure you told us, I just don't remember, don't have it written down, what the difference in the recreation department, what they say they have to have versus what we're putting in there. Before you answer that, are we gearing any of our philosophy on the fact that they may not even be able to play a season due to the pandemic, number two? And then, of course, on the, and I'm sure you're going to hit on the Board of Elections, but I am concerned about, well, both of them.
Right. So the total decrease proposed for the Parks Department is $122,739. That includes reductions for the football program. That program is a $31,000 program that would be reduced. Youth basketball program, $43,000 reduction for basketball. Baseball, softball would be a $35,000 reduction. And then various senior programs, special population programs, and camps for $13,700. My understanding from Brian Baker, the director of the Recreation Parks Department, is that the youth football program more than likely will not be able to be held due to the guidance he's getting from the state. So the department's being told contact sports, even in kids, right now they're being recommended not to have because of the virus. My understanding from Brian also is the basketball program is doubtful, but possible. The basketball program usually starts in late November, early December. So you know, I think we all hope that by that time we'll be in a place where you know, kids could go back to playing basketball. This proposed budget does not have funds for that. It's not certain whether we'll be in a place to be able to play. But even if we did, the current budget for the Parks Department does not have funding for basketball program or for baseball, softball in the spring. The reason being is because of the dramatic decrease in sales tax revenue. So I think for youth football and youth basketball, there is concern about from a virus perspective. For youth baseball and softball next spring, it is strictly financial. I think Brian is here up in the back if you have any further questions.
What are the numbers for the latter three that you mentioned? What was it, baseball?
Baseball and softball is a $35,000 program for the department, basketball $43,000, and football $31,000.
Well, now, separate, you don't mind, the pandemic concerns versus lack of money.
So, youth football, I don't believe is going to be able to happen, period. It actually starts next month, I believe, Brian.
August 1st, yeah.
August 1st. So, our understanding is that program is not going to be able to happen. So that was a $31,000 reduction made because in all likelihood, they will not be able to play football, period. Basketball, I believe that's a December start?
Yeah, December.
That is a $43,000 cut. It's possible. It's uncertain if it would be there, but the money will not be there. But it's possible in December we could be looking at inability to play that sport. That's getting a little more possible COVID, definitely financial reduction. The baseball softball program, as I said, I think we all hope by next spring, April start, is that right, Brian?
March, yeah.
We would hope that we're in a place where we're not as concerned about the coronavirus and would be able to play. But per this budget, those funds would not be here. If you recall, commissioners, what I suggested before was as we go through the months between July and December, we'll be reporting to you regularly how we're doing on sales tax revenue. And if sales tax revenue returns, I don't believe there's any way we'll be doing youth football, personally. Basketball with a start in December, it's possible, I certainly hope so, that sales tax revenue has returned. And that is one of the programs I would certainly encourage the board to consider putting funding back to. And if we can have it from a health perspective, and the tax revenue is back, we should bring it back. And it's, to me, it would be the same case for baseball, softball. If we're past the coronavirus scare and issue in the spring of next year and sales tax has returned, I would suggest that commissioners consider adding those funds back and bringing that program back.
Out of curiosity, Brian, what happened to the money for the spring ball season?
Sorry to scream from the balcony up here, but any money that was paid to us from last season has been returned to the people who paid.
Have we been able to determine a methodology to track retail sales, which would be more current than tracking
through the sales tax revenue that we receive?
Nothing that I think myself or our finance and budget staff feel like is as accurate as the information we get from the Association of County Commissioners. That is specifically the collections for the months. I think that's about as accurate as we could get. I would feel most comfortable using that to tell the board as we go what we think we're actually going to bring in. I think that's probably the best way that we've seen to do that.
Is there a way to use any of the tourism money towards youth ball?
So we've projected a significant cut to the occupancy tax dollars too. Obviously, less folks are coming out in this county spending the night. I think we're proposing a 50% reduction to the amount we think we'll get in occupancy tax for this coming year. So I know the entities that get those funds from us, they certainly want every dollar that they can get. I think there are funds at the TDA, but I'm not sure that they're able to be used to administer the direct cost of the youth sports program. I'll let Brian, you comment on that.
Yeah, certainly the one-third that comes to the county, that can be used at your discretion, but the two-thirds that go to the Tourism Development Authority, statutorily, I don't think they'd be capable of funding something for local residents.
Like so that. There is a potential part of that.
The part that we give out to local entities, as Brian said, that's already been cut 50%, the amount right. We're giving to them, so certainly possible, but tough.
You mentioned that the people who had paid the fees for the spring sports had gotten their money back from that. But what about the county general fund dollars that were going to fund the baseball and softball in the spring? Since we didn't have those sports, what happened to the general fund dollars that had been budgeted to that for fiscal year 19?
Yeah, they're mostly unspent. They'll be returned at the end of the year.
So that could be a carryover that could be used for next year, or is that?
It's possible, yes. I think I want to make sure I see how we are finishing up 19-20, because I know we were getting pretty close to the spending fund balance, so, but that is a possibility yet.
Do you have any other questions or remarks or comments?
Yeah, I would like to ask on the Board of Elections situation. I understand their philosophy and their belief that, you know, that's a prayer that we get that money if we ask for it. But what happens if we fully fund or partially fund or whatever the gap beyond what you submitted? What happens to the availability of those supposed funds if we don't ask for them? I mean, is it just money that we could have got that we didn't get, or how could you answer that?
I actually have put together a couple of slides, just a few, if the commissioners are interested in seeing that, to kind of try to address, because I know the Board of Elections budget has been one of the major concerns, obviously, as we sit here this evening. So if the commissioners are interested, I have about four slides I can run through that will.
Yeah, I'd like to say
that. I think it'd be best to go down that road first.
Right, I might comment too, but I do know that Kathy Holland, our Board of Elections Director, is over in her office right now.
Yes.
And is available for a call if we have any questions.
That's correct. Yes, I'd be happy to call Kathy on the phone and get her in so she can answer any questions too. In the meantime, I'm just going to run through some information about the Board of Elections budget for next fiscal year. So if you could advance me, I don't think my clicker's working. So the original total request for the fiscal year 2021 budget by the Board of Elections was a little over $1.3 million, $1,316,937. So since we've done the manager's recommended budget, Ms. Holland has come back with a revised total budget that she suggests the Board of Elections could operate on. That dollar amount is now $1,035,109. That's the amount that Ms. Holland suggests that the department would be able to run and accommodate next year's elections. That's a $281,828 reduction from the original request at budget retreat. And the majority of that $281,000 reduction, I think it's around $210,000, $220,000, was for additional space rental. So So the Board of Elections was interested in leasing new space for equipment. We currently lease space in several places for the equipment the Board of Elections has. They were interested in leasing new space and also some security carts that would be new that you heard several speakers discuss. So currently in the recommended budget that you have, I've recommended $601,580 from the general fund to fund the Board of Elections budget. And the Board of Elections also has in designation, as you just talked about, the possibility of taking some funds from this fiscal year in the Parks Department, earmarking them for operations, rolling them over. Well, that's happened multiple times in over history for the Board of Elections. So currently the Board of Elections has $344,427 that are designated. They had been planned for uses in previous budgets. They've been carried over, and they would be available for operations in 2021. So if the commissioners added all the dollars that the Board of Elections have in designated funds, in saved funds, county funds, to the $601,000 that is in the recommended budget, the total available for Board of Election operations in 2021 would be $946,007. The difference between that dollar amount and the revised request from the Board of Elections is $89,102. So again, this is not the original budget retreat request by the Board of Elections, which was 1.3. They have since reduced that dollar amount. And if you use all designated funds plus what's been budgeted in the new budget, we'd be within about $89,000 of meeting the need. Next slide, please. So we also, as mentioned, and you heard lots of comments from the citizenry, concerns about how COVID-19 will affect elections next fiscal year. We do have access to coronavirus monies. Right now we have received, and we'll be talking about this later tonight, a little over $3 million in coronavirus assistance money. And we're recommending that the board earmark, and we've talked about this several times, $100,000 specifically for the elections department. And then we're also tonight asking you to approve a budget amendment to apply for and accept a grant that we've been invited to apply for from the federal government for another $58,008. Both of these pots of money are at our discretion how to use them, the $100,000 or this new $58,000 that we've been asked to go after. And I'm recommending to you that we put it toward the Board of Elections operations next fiscal year, particularly for COVID needs. So additional cleaning, absentee ballots, things like that, whatever we can demonstrate the state and federal government is related to COVID, these $158,000 would be used for that next year for the Board of Elections. Again, these are optional. This is a choice that we would be making to do. Then we do have access to $186,507 from the state. This is part of the House Bill 1169 that was just approved. We've been told by the state that our allocation, there was millions of dollars funded by the federal government and the state. Our share, Alamance County, that has been shown to us that we would receive is $186,507. Those must be spent with the Board of Elections. And I am not familiar with all the uses of those funds. I know it's COVID related. It also has to do with absentee ballots. I think the state realizes that counties are going to be experiencing additional costs due to the virus and due to having to do business in a new way at the Board of Elections. So that $186,000 is specifically for Board of Elections.
If you don't apply for it, what happens? Well, I know we don't get it, but I mean,
I'm not sure about the House Bill 1169. Those are allocated specifically by the state. We'll do whatever we've got to do to get those funds, whether it's apply for, send in paperwork. I don't know off the top of my head if it's us or the Board of Elections that actually has to do that, but we will get those funds. The $100,000 in the top line we already have. We have that in our hands. The $58,000 that is added to that, the federal government contacted us and said, you've received grants from us before. These are COVID funds that you're eligible for. Please apply for them. So we have already sent in the application and have the paperwork for the formal approval for the board tonight. So I feel the $100,000 and the $158,000 is in our hands now. The $58,000 we've been told is ready for us. Please apply. And we hope to get very soon.
Would that be within the first quarter, you think?
I believe so, yes. I think most of these funding sources, federal and state, realize that there's time sensitive for this.
And the funding from the state, again, guaranteed to be used by the Board of Elections. So the total dollar amount available for the Board of Elections for COVID-19 uses is $344,515. I cannot stand here tonight and guarantee you that this money can be used to close the gap between the revised request from the Board of Elections and the total amount of county dollars we have between the new budget and the designated funds. I can't tell you that. I can tell you that we will spend a lot of time with Kathy and her staff analyzing the planned expenditures that the Board of Elections has, because, you know, they, when they put together their budget, it's true they really weren't planning for COVID-related issues. So our desire will be to work with the Board of Elections to try to figure out what of your planned expenses in your budget can we use some of these COVID funds for, or the state House Bill 1169 for. And we're certain that the Board of Elections is going to see additional costs due to COVID for cleaning or other purposes that these funds can be used for. Yes, sir.
If I'm not mistaken, in the House Bill 1169, doesn't that allow them to use funds for the printing of the ballots, the absentee ballots, because that's an extraordinary expense?
That's my understanding, but I would certainly defer to Kathy Holland and her folks for the specifics of the bill. My understanding is there are certain uses like that these funds can be used for. But again, Kathy would be the expert.
Expenses?
I believe so. But again, these are funds that we would be working with Kathy to accurately determine how best to spend them, whether that's to print absentee ballots or to clean voting places or whatever we would need to do to make the elections function.
Quick math, doesn't this bring us back up to about where they were, their original request?
Well, I believe so. If you take the 344, if we were able to spend every bit of that, either for COVID-related costs or to help close that $89,000 gap, yes, you'd be around $1.3 million. But again, please note, it's very important that we note that the COVID funds, they will come, they have strings on them from the state and the federal government. And we would have to work, as we're doing with the COVID funds that we'll be talking about later tonight, the coronavirus relief monies, we're working with NC Pro to figure out how can we use these. This is all very new. There is a lot of uncertainty about how the money can be used, but it would certainly seem worth the effort to figure it out and to try to apply them.
I know one of the comments I heard over and over and over again was the requirement for the Board of Elections to have to come back to the Board of Commissioners in order to get approval for a change in their budget. But these COVID funds, I understand, would have to require that we account for every dollar, every penny. Otherwise, we have to refund it in some cases to the originating source, right?
That's correct. So the general fund, the county dollars that are in the designated funds for the Board of Elections, they require budget amendment currently from the commissioner. So that if you could back me up one slide, please. The $344,427, if the commissioners wanted to add that to the general fund dollars of $601,000 for the budget for next year, that's, you either do that one time at some point with a vote to put it all in there, or you do it, you can do some of it, you can add some of it, or you can have Board of Elections come and request those funds through a budget amendment, as we do routinely. You can do it that way too. If you could advance, please. But the $344,515 from COVID funds, those are, we're having to keep those in a special right. revenue fund, because we have to just analyze every time we spend those dollars. So if the Board of Elections wanted to spend any of the $344,515, they'd be working with our group to analyze their expenditure. If it meets the particular criteria for whatever pile it's coming from, whether it's coming from the federal grant, the state grant, or whoever, if it meets the criteria, it can be used. We would say yes, at staff level, it's possible to approve those expenditures.
I think this might be a critical question. If that $344 gets spent, can it be spent on an item that has been budgeted?
I believe so,
budget
yes.
For expense, can it be spent for that if it's in fact a budgeted expense?
I believe so, but again, it might depend on which pot it's coming out of, whether it's the state or the federal monies. That might make a difference too. We would have to look at every possible expenditure. If we find an expenditure in the Board of Elections budget next year that's COVID related or can be tied to COVID related, that would have to be one of our questions. If we've got funding budgeted for
absentee ballot printing now, right? If the commissioners increase the Board of Elections budget with the designated funds, and Ms. Holland puts some of that into the budget to pay for additional absentee ballot printing, it's possible some of these funds may not be able to be used then. It's also possible it may not make a difference. I think if the board wants to do that, we would be working with Kathy to try to figure out how best to allocate the general fund, the designated dollars, to leave these dollars as flexible as possible too. Again, please understand, this is the first time we've worked through something like this. I don't think we've ever been in a place where we've had funds related to a pandemic that have come to the county that in some cases the state is not as certain as we are there, but there's a lot of uncertainty with these funds, period. I think the state is trying to make them as flexible as possible, but then the accountability bug starts biting and they say, wait, we need to put a few more rules on you. So all of this will be difficult to work through. The advantage is, from the perspective of balancing the budget, we're not having to, everybody is fighting for the limited resources that we have this year. With the sales tax projected to be down as low as I think it will be, all that revenue is needed all over the place. If the Board of Elections has access to saved county dollars and COVID monies, that means we've got to work real hard with them to figure out how to spend it. We are willing to do that.
Well, I think too that we need to recognize that your role and the role of finance in the county has been to try and figure out how this is going to balance.
Yes.
And I have to say, I think that the way you have presented the budget has been intended to protect the county for the use of these potential funds. It appears now they're more certain funds.
Yes.
Such that we'll have those funds available to spend without having to use tax dollars when we can use those tax dollars someplace else.
Yes.
Now, that's led, I think, to the misunderstanding that we've dealt with. I've sent out, I can't count the emails, I know other commissioners have too, I've sent out responses trying to explain this process, and I think if we think we can use the designated funds to help them approach a balance so they're not having to come to us for every request, we would be in a better position, as long as it doesn't hurt us in getting these dollars spent appropriately to save us dollars to use in other places. We don't know when the sales tax revenue is going to rebound. I hope, and I think from observations in the county recently, that it's going to rebound fairly quickly. I mean, I was out this last weekend. I've told several people that places I was at were packed. People were buying as fast as they could go. So I hope we're going to see a rebound, but we don't know.
If we could advance the slide, please. So this will give the commissioners an idea of the Board of Elections budget history. So you can see back in 2016, fiscal year 16-17, the budget for the Board of Elections was $896,583. That was the adopted budget for the department. And the actual expenditures are in the column on the right. So this fiscal year, the current budget, adopted budget for the Board of Elections is $927,962. Their amended budget is higher because we have bought voting equipment this year, so we took a loan out for, it was over $1.1 million. So those funds have been put in their budget. We're buying the equipment, we're buying the voting booths and the bags. But their operating budget, their adopted budget was $927,962. You can see what was actually spent each year in the right column. I think this year we're on target for about $895,000 in spending in the Board of Elections budget. An analysis has shown me that it's about $820,000. There's probably $70,000 to $75,000 worth of one-time expenditures in the Board of Elections budget this year. They're paying rent on their storage space, which we are moving into the county maintenance department in the fiscal year 2021 budget that you have in front of you. And they also did upfit to that space. So if you recall, we leased some space at the Medicap building. They had to go in and do some upfit, and they've been paying the lease out of their budget. We've moved the lease payments over into maintenance, and the upfit is now complete. So
I think, if I had to estimate, we're probably around $820,000 in real true operations costs. So for 2021, the current recommended budget is $601,000 and a little more. And you have access to increase the Board of Elections budget up to $946,007 from county funds. We still have the $344,515 in COVID funds. And if all else fails, if we spend all the county dollars, all $946,000 of it, and we can't apply a dime of COVID, or COVID costs are eat this all up, we do have our unassigned fund balance. I think I know the commissioners would agree with me that elections are extremely important, and we want fair and safe and efficient elections, as do I, and I know every commissioner does too. That's what unassigned fund balance is for. If we burn through all this money or find that it is unusable, then we have $22.8 million that I believe that's what we will have at the end of 1920 in our savings that we can also tap. That does take a budget amendment. It does take us coming to the Board of Elections coming to the board saying, here's what we have done. We've run through all this. We're $80,000. That will get us over the top. By all means, I would certainly recommend, if we have exhausted all the county dollars and the COVID money, and we still need it, and it's to make sure the election is fair and critical and efficient, we have this. We have our own savings to do that with too.
Can we do that with a resolution to do that? I mean, as part of our budget.
I think I'm sure the board could. I'm not sure of the legalities of that. I don't know if the county attorney can speak to that. But I think what you're saying is the possibility of doing a resolution to say if you use
all of, if we don't get these COVID funds, which we think we will, but yeah.
If what we would be saying is if we use all the new general fund money, the designated general fund money, and the COVID money either doesn't apply or we spend all of it, would the board be supportive of using the fund balance? I don't know if a resolution is necessary to do that or not. I don't know. I think that would be.
I would be okay with that.
I think maybe just a general consensus among us that, yeah, that would be the intention rather than.
Well, I'll be here.
Yeah, there's not going to be any
just
more.
Right.
But she's going to call her, you know, the biggest show she's got all every election year is within the first quarter. I would say, right?
Yes. Okay. Yes, I think, you know, with elections, they're working on it now. They've been working on it and are starting to spend money now and are needing funding pretty quickly. So,
but is that still giving them the 300 and whatever that was in the designated the capital reserve or whatever?
So currently, it is not in their 2021 budget. The only dollars that are in their 2021 budget is the $601,000 that's from the recommended. The commissioners would have to vote to amend their budget. And you can either do that now or you can do that in July, whenever. You can do it as you go or however the commissioners want to do it. But at this point, it will take a vote by the commissioners to add any of those designated funds to the Board of Elections budget.
What's the downside of not doing it? I mean, I've given it to them myself. I mean, it's their money. They said their barrel.
Yes.
I was saying.
Yes.
I don't have a problem doing it now. I mean,
is the motion in order?
Yeah.
I'll make a motion that we allocate the designated fund monies available to the Board of Elections for their use and add it to the manager's recommended fund.
I'll second that.
Okay, so that is a motion to approve. Let me take off my mask. Let's say this.
I want to say
a motion to approve the manager's recommended budget with the amendment that the $344,427 in designated funds for the Board of Elections be moved to the Board of Elections budget for fiscal year 2021.
Right.
Is that your motion?
Yes.
I want a second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion about that? Before we vote, I will just indicate my preference on this budget. I got a lot of skin in the game for Alamance Burlington School System. And I took a lot of heat in 2017 because they didn't get the increase that they had requested, but they still got an 8.22% increase. The call from both sides on that one. And then in 2018, I agreed to raise property taxes so that they could get the continuation request. 2019, I voted to fund the bonds that had passed, the bond resolution that had passed the general public. So I am going to go ahead and indicate that I will not be voting for this motion because of, for two reasons. One, we just worked so hard in this community for so long to support ABSS and get the teacher supplements up to 10th in the state to, you know, build those buildings, do great things for ABSS, and it just, I'm going to take a stand on that tonight. And also, John Coleman's remarks about the youth sports, that just cuts to my spirit. I know we all hate this virus and what it's done to our communities. The two people that it has affected, or two groups of people that it has affected so cruelly, have been one, the people who have had loved ones have to go into the hospital or into nursing homes or some kind of facility and not been able to visit them or hold their hand while they pass away from a illness unrelated to COVID. And then the other thing is what it's done to our children with taking them out of the school system and disrupting their little lives. And the whole thing with the sports and the Special Olympics, it just cuts in my heart, and I know it does everybody else. I know it does the other commissioners as well. But my vote doesn't have anything to do with not approving of the logic and the thinking about the Board of Elections budget or moving the money from the designated funds and making it available to them. So we have a motion and a second on the floor. Is there any more discussion?
Jim, how, and I mean this with all due respect, how are you linking the Board of Elections situation to the schools?
I
thought I missed something.
Yes, so. I'm sorry. I didn't have it written out, so I stumbled over.
Well, I must have missed it, and I apologize.
Yeah. Is there any other discussion? If not, all in favor of the motion, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? No. So that takes care of that item on our agenda. Shall we take a break? We have 2 hours.
Yes.
So we'll take a 10-minute recess. All right, so we'll resume session now. The next item on the agenda is the reimbursement resolution for ABSS bond projects. And as part of that, we also need to discuss the adoption of the capital plan. Mr. Hagus, do you have anything to say about that?
Yes, indeed. So, Commissioners, if you'll recall, at the recommended budget, we also presented you with a copy of the updated version of the Alamance County Capital Plan. I have some information. I can go back over it with the commissioners. Basically, the capital plan gives us a direction to go next fiscal year in all our capital efforts. We've edited it to make sure it matches with the budget. So, as you know, in this budget, we cut our CIP money for county government, so the capital plan shows that too. We have tweaked the plan for next fiscal year based on some of the timeline changes that the education bond projects have had. It's not a tremendous amount of change in the capital plan from last year, but once a year, we want to bring it to the commissioners, put it before you, ask that you vote to do it. It does not mean that it's giving us permission to move forward on spending money or doing things that are in the plan, but it does mean the commissioners have had a chance to look at it, review it, you agree this is the direction that we should go. So I'd like to ask that the board consider approving the capital plan for fiscal year 2021.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Thank you. Motion by Mr. Carter and a second by Mr. Vossel to approve the capital plan. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay. And then what's next?
So we have it ties into the capital plan, a reimbursement resolution change for Alamance Board of School Systems. I'd like that. Susan, would you please pass a copy of both of these to each commission? So we currently, for the education bond projects, we have a reimbursement resolution in place. The commissioners passed
the current reimbursement resolution on February 3rd of 2020. And what that resolution did was front $7,448,926 to the school system so they could get started on all the preliminary work, the design work, survey type work for the new high school, for Southern High School, for South Midland Elementary Project, and it also included some funding for Williams High School design. So we currently have a reimbursement resolution in place for $7.4 million. And later tonight, we fronted that money out of our unassigned fund balance. Later tonight in the year-end cleanup that Susan will be talking to you about, we're going to move, change that from instead of coming out of unassigned fund balance, it will come out of the school system's capital reserve that's been building this year, which will be very helpful to the county. That's going to bring us back to that $22 million I was talking about earlier in unassigned fund balance. So the current $7.4 million reimbursement resolution is for the new high school land costs. It was approximately $2.6 million. Also for construction manager at risk and design fees, geographical testing and surveys. That's a little over $4.2 million. And then there were costs that the school system had incurred before February 3rd. That's a little over $600,000. So what we're asking the board to consider tonight is to increase that reimbursement resolution from $7.4 million to add an additional $4 million to that reimbursement resolution, which would take the new dollar amount to $11,448,926. The reason being is that additional $4 million will allow for one half of the South Midland construction project to go ahead and begin. So the school system is at a point where they are prepared to begin the construction projects at South Midland. You have this documentation in your hand. In just a moment, I'm going to call Todd Thorpe, put him on speakerphone. He's going to talk to you a little bit about this project. But the idea would be to increase the reimbursement resolution to the $11 million so the school system can go ahead and begin the construction piece at South Midland. Then we're going to issue debt. The plan is to issue debt in March for this project. So we would pay back the school system's capital reserve and have the money in hand to finish out the rest of the South Midland project, which the total dollar amount for the South Midland Elementary School Education Bond project is $8,482,880. So at this point, I'm going to attempt to call Todd Thorpe and put him on speakerphone. Hey, Todd, this is Brian Haygood at the County Commissioner meeting. You may want to turn down your feed in the background.
You're about 2 seconds away from behind over here, okay.
So we've got the County Commissioners here, and they've been given a copy of the documents that you provided for us. So they're listening to hear a little bit about the South Midland project. Thank you, Todd.
Any questions, or?
I think the board is good.
Okay. All right. Thank you, sir.
Don't leave yet.
Okay.
So the resolution does take a vote to approve, and again, we're going to move the funding from our unassigned fund balance in a little bit to the school system's capital reserve that has built, and front this money to get this project started. And then the plan is to issue debt March of 21 to pay for the entire project. So we'll reimburse the school system's capital reserve that we're going to take from to get it started and pay for the rest of the project.
This is one where we have a caption to be read from somebody who's inclined, say Mr. Boswell is inclined to make a motion.
Yeah.
And if he could read that.
I would like to make a motion for the resolution of the Board of Commissioners for the County of Alamance, North Carolina, declaring its intention to reimburse said county from the proceeds of one or more tax-exempt financing for certain capital expenditures.
Okay, Mr. Boswell has made a motion and Mr. Carter has seconded it. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Before you let him go, he mentioned mobiles. Ask him, Todd, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Tim Sutton, how many mobiles do we feel like we're going to have in our system once we're through with all the projects?
Once we remove, say, well, we're right at 50 right now, by removing the mobiles at South Mountain, they have one classroom or one extension with three mobiles. You got three other mobiles, so that's six mobiles. I'm not saying that we won't relocate some replaceable ones, but we should be in the 42-43 range.
Just with South Mountain, but just with the South Mountain project?
You know, years ago when we looked at the mobiles, I think the state average was 10% of the populations were in mobiles. We were at 5 then. What are we now, and what is the state average? Do you have any idea?
No, sir. I've checked it recently.
Yeah, I'd like to know that if you could get it just for the sake of information.
At the end of the bond projects, where will we be in mobiles?
So did you hear that question, Todd?
No, sir.
So Commissioner Carter was asking, at the end of the bond projects, all the bond projects, any idea of if completing South Memphis gets us to about 42 mobiles, would you have any idea of once all the bond projects are completed, where we will be with a possible total number of mobile classrooms then?
Thank you, Dr. Thorpe.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
The next item on the agenda is a detention center food service contract. Sheriff Johnson, are you going to present that or is somebody here?
Good evening, Commissioners. I have with me tonight Mr. Derek Harless, who's with Aramark Food Company, and of course our Captain Coley Rich. You know, the time has come when we're having to tighten our belts. You commissioners know that we're having 15 of our positions frozen at the sheriff's office. Currently we have 8 detention officers working in the cafe there at the jail or in our area room feeding the inmates. Also, the prices on the food that we have been buying from State's Garden Fresh Market has gone up extensively. To give you an example, actual cost from June 2019 through May of 2020 for the food for 461, and that was our average daily population, was $869,249.80. With Aramark Industry, or Aramark Food Company, with 3 hot meals like we serve currently, would be $830,775.40, which is a cut in price. But they're good. They have in other detention centers, hospitals. It's good food. We've called around. We appointed a group from the sheriff's office to look at the bid process with looking at the cost 30%, staffing plan 20%, ability to meet requirements 30%, and quality of bid 20%. We called around to the companies that are the agencies that had Aramark Food Services. All gave glowing comments. After looking at it, our group that we appointed selected out of 4, there's only 4 companies that bid it. looked at the bid process and chose our Mark Food over all the rest of it. And if you have any question, he come all the way to Illinois, I believe, in here tonight to
Florida.
Oh, I thought it was Illinois.
I looked at Illinois, yeah.
Hey, we put that.
And to meet with the commissioner if you have any questions. And the way I look at it, gentlemen, we have 8 people working in the kitchen right now, detention officers. We're freezing 15. We can take some of those 8, majority of those 8, and put them on the detention floor where they need to be. Certainly, we're going to have to work with Airmark to help them get on board, because they're going to have to hire people coming in. Is that not correct?
Absolutely.
And working with them, whatever it takes. But in the long run, I think we will come ahead of the ball game, and I think we're going to save some money for the county. I think a lot of money for the county, to be honest with you, and a whole lot less headaches. Plus, we've had several injuries in the kitchen that people are on workman's comp that's costing the county, that are officers. So we're looking forward to it and hope you allow us to select them as our contract food service.
Got a question for Airmark. How many people would you be hiring then for those slots approximately?
Based on the population, when we proposed, it was like 560, 13 people.
13?
Plus a manager.
And the average salary?
Based on experience. We've found out over the course of time that minimum wage just doesn't cause anything but operational issues, right? So, but based on experience, you're looking at probably $12 to $13 starting for just a cook. Lead supervisors up to $15, $16 now. We have a salary manager be overseeing that operation at
$50. Okay. So 14 potential jobs above minimum wage.
That would ramp up, probably not initially because the populations are low. But as it increases, we would hire.
Right now, like today, I think we had 306 inmates in detention center. So certainly, you know, the cost will be up a little bit because of the lower number.
If anybody's thinking about making a motion, if they could include in their motion, given the county manager the authority to sign the contract, that would be useful.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Before we vote, can you comment on the facilities that we have here? Are they totally sufficient?
Absolutely.
So nothing else would need to be done on our part?
No, all the equipment's working. Everything is in place that we would need in an industrial kitchen to feed that number of population. And as long as everything's working, the county's responsible for, you know, replacement repairs. But we train our people on how to use that, even if they're new to the industry, new to industrial feeding. We want to make sure that they're trained properly on that equipment.
What about the main state unit over in Graham? Where is that? Is that empty now? We got people there?
We got
48, I think, there this morning.
What do we do, transfer food?
Transfer the food over there in a van.
Okay, we have a motion. Is there more discussion? If not, we have a motion by Mr. Lashley to approve the terms of the contract and give Brian Haygood the authority to sign the contract, and a second to that motion by Mr. Carter. If there's no more discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Great, thank you.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming from Florida.
Great. Next item on the agenda is just a possible vote on the Coronavirus Relief Funds Action Plan. Mr. Hagers.
So, Commissioners, I think this is the third time I've been before you about the Coronavirus plan, but I think we've got the final version tonight. This is what I'm recommending to the commissioners. We've brought it to you a couple times. Listen to what the board's thoughts were, talked about it internally, and been working very closely with folks at NC Pro to try to stay compliant. So I'm going to go over it with you. I think
I just not having any luck with the clicker, so if someone could advance me a slide. They told me it was off a minute ago, but I see, maybe if I see green, it's right. Yes, there we go. So if you remember, the state gave CARES Act funds to counties to help help counties fight the COVID virus and to cover COVID-related costs in 1920 and in 2021. We've developed a final budget plan, and you have it in your agenda that includes the template we'll be sending to the state as well as our cost plan. And the total dollar amount the county received was $3,007,967. So we have developed a budget plan for that dollar amount. That's what we've received, and we have it in our hands right now at county government. And our deadline for the CRF plan is June 15th, so we have actually sent this plan. We went ahead and sent it in today. The board doesn't agree or wants to make changes tonight, we can do that, but we went ahead and sent it in because today was the deadline. And the plan that we've prepared basically has three pieces to it. One is Alamance County COVID-related costs, both in 1920 and in 2021. I'm also going to make a recommendation to you about funding some of the COVID-related costs for our municipalities. And we talked last time about the possibility of a small business loan for businesses that have been impacted by the COVID virus. And we'll talk about that. We have a couple of guests that are joining us, I think, by conference call that will talk about that too. So just to touch on the county piece of the COVID relief funds, our plan is budgeted a little over $2.2 million for county government to use toward the cost that the county has incurred and will incur in 2021 for fighting the COVID virus. Again, you have all these forms in your packet. So the way we have broken down our $2.2 million for county government is allowable county staff costs from 1920 and from 2021, what we foresee coming. We're having to work with the state to make sure that we only apply these funds to help cover costs for staff that are what's the term, sustainably or
dedicated,
yes. So the state's helping us determine how we can spend these monies, but it's a little over $1 million. We've also included in our county portion of the plan $840,000 to do hazard pay for eligible county staff, which I'll give you the details again about here in a moment. And we're looking at the possibility of that happening twice in the event we're back into wave two, which I certainly hope we are not, but if come this winter, where our folks are working as hard as they have worked up until today, then we will look at the possibility of doing another hazard pay for appropriate staff. We're also looking at a little over $200,000 for technology and for detention cleaning costs to try to make sure our detention center stays COVID-free. We've also spent a great deal of money on technology, new broadband, Zoom calls, new tech to try to account for folks social distancing and staying at home. And then finally, as I talked about earlier, as we were talking about the budget, we have chosen to earmark $100,000 of this $2.2 million specifically for elections-related costs. So that's part of that $344,000 that we talked about earlier. So the pieces of the county's plan that are really coming to bear quickly, one of the main ones is the employee hazard pay. This is a one-time bonus, as we've talked about before. That would be for first responders or for other county employees who their jobs put them at a significant risk of exposure to the coronavirus. That they would have to work in critical settings directly with folks that either have the coronavirus or are suspected of having the coronavirus. This is not for folks at county government that are just general public interaction like myself. You have to have really intense and intimate interactions. Public health nurses, EMS, and I'll go over some of the other departments too. But myself and Sherry Hook and the department heads have all looked at different positions. And you've seen this before at our last meeting. We've determined that eligible employees would be ones from public health, EMS, emergency management, CCOM, fire marshal, and DSS. The only thing that's changed in this set of information from the last time I showed it to you, the EMS part-time employees were scheduled to only receive $750, but upon further reflection and discussion with Ray Vipperman, our EMS director, it seemed appropriate that our part-time EMS employees are running ambulances and right up on folks that either have the coronavirus or are suspected of having it, so we've increased that to match the public health tier two.
So these are the different, these are one-time bonuses that these employees would receive. Total of 270 total employees. Everyone at EMS, CCOM, and Emergency Management would be eligible. Our Social Services Department includes Adult and Child Protective Services, and that they are going out, going into folks' homes. So are the foster care social workers. Our Health Department has identified people by the work they've assigned. Health has been all hands on deck for the coronavirus, so it's health nurses and lots of other people. We're helping at testing sites, helping in the clinics. So the total cost to give each one of these employees the bonuses as it breaks down in this chart is $368,280. Those would be paid from the coronavirus funds. That's actually less than we budgeted. We budgeted $420,000 to possibly happen twice. We're at $368,000. And again, these would come from our coronavirus funding. We're also proposing this evening the Sheriff's Department. The other folks have worked very hard too in detention and patrol. Sheriff's Department employees would be eligible for a $1,500 bonus, but these funds do not come from coronavirus monies. The sheriff has found a way to pay for these funds from his fiscal year 1920 budget, so they will not be part of this coronavirus money, but it's a similar bonus, one time $1,500. For both the hazard pay for the folks getting paid from the coronavirus money and the Sheriff's Department staff, there's a budget amendment as a part of this plan that the board would have to approve, and then we would be able to have checks actually earlier than the 30th, but by the 30th at the absolute latest. I'm also recommending this evening, we talked a lot about what, you know, should the county share some of these proceeds with the municipalities. We sent a request to all the municipalities in Alamance County to respond to us with what they foresee their COVID-related costs to be. We had seven municipalities respond. You can see them here on the board. And you can see their total request from the seven was a little over $2 million. And I'm recommending earmarking $600,000 from our $3 million to be given to the municipalities, or I shouldn't say given, designated for them to apply for, because we have to make sure that whatever we give them meets the terms that the state has given to spend these funds. So you see all the requests from each one of the cities that responded and the recommendations in the right hand column. We looked at the $600,000, breaking it down per capita. Some of the counties around the state are using that formula based on population. When we did that, it got the dollar amounts for Green Level, Gibsonville, and Hall River were very close to the dollar amount that they had requested anyway. It just seemed to work out that way. Elon was significantly off, but their students contribute to that, and of course the students have been gone for a lot of this virus. So it made sense to us to just say for Green Level, Gibsonville, Hall River, and Elon, we would fund exactly what they requested. That's about $85,000 total. The remaining $515,000 of the $600,000 would be broken up per capita for the other three cities. So you can see that Burlington would receive almost $340,000, or the ability to apply for $340,000. Graham would have received the ability to apply for a little over $97,000, and the city of Mebane would receive the ability to apply for a little over $75,000. Again, the commissioners can tweak these dollar amounts. However, this seems to make sense to staff. So the final piece of our plan is a small business loan piece. And we talked a lot last time about grants. We determined with the county attorney's help and talking with the school of government, lots of other folks, grants just are not going to work for county government. However, we are eligible to do loans. And we talked last time about, is this worth it? Is this something that would help businesses? We reached out to the Chamber of Commerce and the Alamance Community Foundation and asked them, are loans anywhere from $5,000, $10,000, $15,000 valuable to small businesses? And it was a resounding yes that they would be, especially if they are quick and have relatively few strings attached, that a lot of small businesses would take advantage of this. So our discussions with the Chamber and the Community Foundation, they reached out to Self-Help Credit Union, which has locations in North Carolina. In fact, there's one in Greensboro, North Carolina. Self-Help Credit Union is already involved in some of this type of program, could have this loan program up very quick. I'm recommending that the commissioners consider earmarking $200,000 from the county's coronavirus relief funds to be put into a one-time loan program. These funds would all have to be loaned out by the end of the calendar year. talking with the folks from the Chamber and the Community Foundation, they were interested in a program like this already, and they have $100,000 in private funds that they would also throw into the mix. Now, their $100,000 would be revolving. Right now, the counties would not. It would be one time to be loaned out by December. As we get paid back to Self-Help Credit Union, we would be paying back the state of North Carolina. But my hope would be we could find some other monies to put in there after the December cutoff, right, from outside sources. These are using the coronavirus funds. It's possible there may be more coronavirus funds that the county could get if the pandemic continues. And there's also a piece to the small business loan program that would involve the community college. The community college has received coronavirus monies to help small businesses navigate the pandemic and learn how to survive and to recover once it's over. So we would incorporate Small Business Center at the college into this piece. So if you get a loan from the county from these funds, you'd be hooked up with the Small Business Center at ACC and be given the opportunity to get some counseling from them about how to survive and hope maybe thrive. Talking with the folks from the Chamber and the Community Foundation, the idea would be to put together a committee locally to set all the parameters for what this loan program would look like. I would imagine we would all want it to be Alamance County businesses. And we would have some stipulations like we talked about Wake and the city of Raleigh had. How many years have you been in business? Can you demonstrate you've been hurt by the COVID virus? This committee with representation from Chamber, Community Foundation, I would suggest a county staff person to make sure we stay compliant with NC Pro. And I would suggest a commissioner or two would be possibly interested in serving on this committee to set these parameters. That would make sense. If this committee could get the loan program details in place, I believe we could be back before the commissioners at the July 20th meeting with the parameters of the program ready to go. Chamber, Community Foundation, County, Self-Help NC, all on board, ready to roll it out July 21st if the commissioners vote that they believe that the parameters are good and they like all the terms. In this model, though, the Self-Help Credit Union would review applications and they would administer the loans. It would not be county government or county staff or the local committee. They would not be doing that. The committee would work to set the parameters and Self-Help Credit Union would administer. So I think we have some folks on the phone, Mac Williams of the Chamber, Fairfax Reynolds of the Alamance Community Foundation. So gentlemen, please chime right in.
Good evening. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, this is Matt from the Alamance Chamber.
Okay. So, Mac, if you want to comment on the discussions that we've had about this would be beneficial to the small business community in Alamance County that are struggling to get through the coronavirus pandemic.
Absolutely. In the heat of the pandemic, not that we're not still in it, but earlier on, a few months back, we were approached multiple times by small business people wondering if there was some special loan program out there, and there was not. We started talking with a group of people in the county about putting together something, and as we talked more about it, we thought that rather than doing small, one-time grant-type approaches, which would be helpful, no doubt about that, but we thought with limited resources, we would be better off and build more agreement among the parties that we wanted. We would rather do some sort of recovery loan-type program, not just to help us get through this particular period, but something that we would have as a tool going forward for more projects down the road. And so we were aligned with having to develop some sort of loan program, and that's when we started talking with the Community Foundation and coming up with the idea of engaging Self-Help Credit Union to be the third-party loan administrator with a local oversight group that you have just explained. So we're pretty excited about it. We've already gotten approval for putting $100,000 of private money in this pool. There will be probably some division between how the public money and how the private money is spread out We want to follow the rules of the public money as well. The private money may have a little more latitude to it, but that's what the committee can come up with and decide, and of course you have more detail for you to react to on July 20th. I know Fairfax Reynolds is here as well. He is the chairman of the Community Foundation, a former community banker. All everybody knows him. Fairfax, if you're on the line, those are. You might want to jump in and talk about the program from the Community Foundation standpoint.
Well, we, yes, we may not, must not have Fairfax.
Mr. Fairfax?
I'm sorry. This is Fairfax Reynolds. Matt had asked the Gavin Stevens Foundation and I to be involved in the program discussing, the group discussing the small business loan program opportunity. And so I was involved in discussions with the Self-Help Credit Union, and what I found for them, and I think the beauty of this program for the community is we have the experience of the Self-Help Credit Union, a community development financial institution, who's administered programs like this all over the state. We have their experience, but we have a program that can be locally designed and crafted for our small business community. So by having this oversight group that does that, working for Self-Help, I think we can craft a program that meets the needs of our business community in light of COVID-19 and how they've been impacted by it. And we all know that it's been impacted very seriously. And do it in a way that we have control over. The Self-Help brings the experience in administering the program, the application process, underwriting documentation, account reporting back to our local committee, and they do an excellent job of that. So I think as designed, this program would be excellent, and I commend the commissioners for earmarking a portion of this COVID relief funds for assisting the small business community that certainly need it. Any questions?
I have a couple of questions. One, how would we segregate the $200,000 that Alamance County might allocate versus the $100,000 from private funds?
Well, Self-Help has told us that they can account for those pool of funds separately. So the money from the county would be, the way the program would be designed as I see it, certifying maybe it can help correct us here, but the money would be loaned to Self-Help. It's loaned to them at 0%. They then make the small business loans at 4%, no application fee, no underwriting fee, just a straight 4% to the borrower. Self-Help, as those loans are repaid, as I understand it, the county then has to account for that money and perhaps get back to the funding source. So Self-Help would do that. They would collect the repayment of the funds, account for it, and then allocate it or send it back to the county as required. The money that is coming from the private source is a revolving loan fund. So as loans are repaid from that fund, those loans have been relent. That's not true, as I understand it, for the public money. So that's the difference, and they would be accounted for differently.
That's correct. I believe, if I understand, the last rules that we saw was we have to remit to the state monthly any paybacks that the county would receive. So if people are paying on their loans, any money that comes back in monthly, the county needs to get from the credit union and send to the state. So again, our funding would have to be loaned out by, I believe, December 30th and gone. So it would be one-time shot, one-time allocation, $200,000 loaned out by the end of the calendar year. And as people make payments, we would have to get it from Self-Help and send it to the state.
Coincidentally, Mr. Sutton and I were having a conversation earlier this evening about problem loans. And
But I don't want to ask Fairfax about that.
None of them were made by us, of course. If these loans don't get repaid, then the county is on the hook to repay the state. Is that correct?
So the state has changed those rules, and the county would not be on the hook for anything that was not repaid.
Okay. That's good news. Okay.
Yes.
The aspect of this program, I think, is important to note is the technical assistance, and Brian Haygood mentioned it, that not only do we have the Small Business Center at ACC, but self-help has other third parties as well as a staff to offer technical assistance. So there's tremendous technical assistance resources available to these small business borrowers through the application process and through the loan term to help them have the best option for recovery and repayment.
And I think another interesting piece of this is that local committee will have the chance to really kind of set the parameters for what businesses you want to target. You know, what are you trying to accomplish with these funds? Is there a size or something along those lines? So, you know, to me, it would make sense to have a representation from all these different groups on the local committee. And if it's, I think that should be reasonably able to accomplish before July 20th, just those details, so I can bring something back to the commissioners for you to review and approve.
Well, I can't speak for Mr. Sutton, but if you're looking for a couple of commissioners with experience in lending,
you better buy me.
I would be interested in helping out in that way.
Well, I think that's a nice segue into the next steps for tonight. I'd like to request that the commissioners consider voting to approve the coronavirus relief fund plan that I've laid out for you tonight. There's a budget amendment in your packet also that allocates the dollars as I've gone through with you. Just know in your mind that if you vote to approve our plan and the budget amendment, we're going to proceed with paying those eligible county employees the one-time hazard pay bonus total $368,280. It'll be paid before June 30th. We will notify the municipalities that we have earmarked $600,000 for their COVID-related costs, and we will tell them how much our formula indicates that they can apply to us for, and I'm sure they will start applying immediately, and we'll be reviewing their applications to make sure their costs meet the state's guidelines. We would also begin this discussion about the $200,000 for small business loans. In fact, I would suggest that we would want to this evening, perhaps, consider someone so we can go ahead and get this started. So the target date would be, I'm back before you, July 20th. So ideally, a commissioner or two, probably no more than two, would be appointed to this committee, right? That would we'll send someone from staff also. There's also $100,000 in this. If you vote to approve the plan and the budget amendment, we earmark $100,000 of this for the Board of Elections for their budget for 2021 also. And we would also ask that you approve the payment of $1,500 bonus pay for the Sheriff's Office employees, not from the coronavirus funds, from the Sheriff's Department budget 1920.
You mean 2020?
Well, yes, I believe so. It's from this fiscal year.
We have moved into next year.
That's right. We're right on the cusp, that's for sure.
Let me ask you a question. Where do the companies go to file for that, to borrow that money?
I think what we would do is work with the Chamber and the Community Foundation to put something at least on our website and the Chamber's website and the Community Foundation's website to get the word out to local small businesses. If Mac's still on the line, he may have some ideas about how to market it, because that would be important to make sure the...
Definitely important.
Absolutely. If you're talking about anywhere from $5,000 to $15,000 loans, those are probably small businesses. So is Mac still on the phone? Mac, would you have any suggestions about how to market this web?
I'm here, and I heard the question, and absolutely. I think our role is going to be along with the oversight function, marketing the program to the community so that we can get these loans out. I know the public monies need to be out before the end of the year, so we certainly have some work to do that, but I think I think money like this, the word that is available gets out pretty quick. So I think we'll probably be able to market it fairly quickly with a pretty good network. We've got a good local network of people that have been talking about doing something like this now for a while. There's this Alamance Strong Group that basically represents most of the business development agencies and almost all the communities around, plus some other agencies as well, like the Small Business Center at ACC. So I think within all that network, once we have the program defined and we have some material that we can send out and run an application process and stuff like that we can market it and handle inquiries.
And commissioners, as I mentioned earlier, that we're not, you know, we budgeted a coronavirus money's $420,000 for hazard pay. We're spending $368,000 if you approve this tonight. If we have funds that are not being spent in some other area, we have the ability to amend this plan. So we could be coming back before December, saying we have an additional $70,000 that we could put in the pot to do additional loans if the board wanted to. If it's going successfully and it seems to be a benefit to the community, we may be able to put even more money in the $200,000.
Well, I might want to add too, I want to recognize Sherry Daly, because this was initially was her idea to make sure we had funds in here with small business, and I think it's a wonderful idea, and I appreciate that.
Great idea.
Well,
that's nice of you to say. Thank you.
And you got one.
Well, great. Well, is there any more questions or discussion? We would be seeking a motion to approve the Coronavirus Relief Funds Action Plan. That would be the first step.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Lashley and Mr. Boswell. We have a motion and a second to approve the plan. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? And then the second step would be seeking a motion to approve the sheriff's office getting their bonuses, the bonus pay for the sheriff's department employees.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion by Mr. Carter and a second by Mr. Lashley to approve that. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? And Mr. Carter has volunteered to be the Board of Commissioners liaison or designee for the loan committee. Thank you for that.
And sounds like fun.
I'm going to check my calendar and see what it looks like and see if I can make that happen for myself, unless Mr. Sutton wants to do it.
I'm fine.
All right. We don't want you to feel crowded.
I'm a little hard on that. I hope Judy's not watching this right now.
All right. Is that it for that item?
That's it. Thank you, Mac Fairfax, for joining us.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you, folks.
Thank you, Mac.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a nice night. Bye.
Thank you. All right, the next item on the agenda, we're going to the budget amendments. We have a budget amendment for the library.
Good evening, commissioners. Hope you have a good night. All right, so I'm before you again asking to your permission to seek another grant. This grant is from the State Library of North Carolina that they received through CARES Act monies that are filtered through the Institute of Museum and Library Services, and if awarded, to amend the budget to be able to accept the money at that time. The purpose of this grant would be to get up to $10,000 to be able to focus on projects that would increase digital access and address the digital divide in our community. So our main focus for this project would be able to purchase hotspots that we could circulate through the library to make available to the community in this time where we know bigger concerns about access to internet has arisen with COVID and people being at home and stuff. So we would like to be able to purchase the hotspots and at least pay for the service funding for the first initial year of this project with the grant money. It doesn't require any county match funds, and I'm coming before you tonight because the grant deadline is in July. I'm still discussing that with the vendors at the moment, but it should be a significant number.
Okay. And people people would check it out just like they would check out a book?
Just like they would check out a book. We would set the checkout parameters. Books are 3 weeks. Hotspots we might set for a month. They would check them out, use them during the time, have probably some sort of contract that says don't try to use it out of the country or things like that. Might not be an issue now, but in the future. But yes, and then they, you know, when their time came up, they would return it just like they would a book.
Mm-hmm. I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, Mr. Boswell has made a motion to approve, and Ms. Carter has seconded it. I think about my grandmother at times like this. She passed away in 1993. She was born in 1902. And I can just imagine saying to her, Grandma, I got to go to the library and get a hot spot. She said, you got to go get what?
Yeah, I think about why she had the antenna, like, dial on her TV to be able to get the whatever, and she would look at me like, I'm crazy. What do we do anymore?
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Goldman. All right, next we have a budget amendment for the Emergency Management Supplemental Grant.
What I'm here tonight for is a budget amendment for approval for a grant for emergency management preparedness supplemental. It is for $12,694.45. This is a matching grant, but it is an in-kind match, which we'll be using, and it's approved for salaries that we are already paying, so it would not require any additional monies from the county to accept this grant. This grant would be used for buying personal protective equipment to be used by emergency services and other agencies throughout the county, and also for planning for future pandemics or that nature of type things. So.
Okay, Mr. Carter has made a motion to approve, and Mr. Lashley has seconded it. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Great. And now we have a budget amendment for the Coronavirus Emergency Supplemental Fund. Who's presenting this? Susan. Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
Good evening, Commissioners. Before you is our request to authorize the application for the Coronavirus Emergency Supplemental Fund grant. We have been notified that we have been eligible to receive $58,008. This does not require any local match, and we would use these funds for our elections.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion by Mr. Lashley and a second by Mr. Boswell. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, and then our last budget amendment. It's a cleanup for the year end, I guess.
That is correct. Before you tonight, Commissioner, is a budget amendment that will accomplish several items for us with our year end budget cleanup, as you were saying earlier. And what this will also do is it will authorize us to do the final budget amendment for our fire districts and municipality tax receipts. We normally receive those after June 30th, but this will allow us to go ahead and make that adjustment as well. So the several items that we can go over real quick, this would allow for $1,500 for a war memorial grant, transfer $131,500 in merit pay from the county manager's budget to several different departments that needed those adjustments, transferring $50,000 from tax administration to revaluation for operations, transferring $200,000 from our U.S. Marshal to our Sheriff's Department for the bonus pay, budgeting $36,368 in transportation grant that benefits ACTA recipients, increasing our ambulance fee for a total of $400,000 for overtime and vacation payouts, budget $1,670,000 for two park grants, the Cane Creek Observation Tower and the Cane Creek Sizemore Tract. What this budget amendment will also do is increase our budget by $800,000. That would be transferred to the school's capital reserve, and that's for our sales tax, that's the restricted portion. That is an estimate only. It could be less, but that way we know we have enough allowance within our budget.
to transfer $600,000 to the workers' compensation claims for funds for claims, and to budget $2.2 million from our unassigned fund balance that would be transferred to the renovation repair project for the projects there. What we'd also take care of is our ACC Capital Project Fund, transferring $1.6 million from the Capital Reserve Fund per the reimbursement resolution, budgeting interest that was earned for the Advanced Applied Technology Center, which would allow for reimbursement to ACC in the amount of $65,546.46, which would close out that project, and to also close out the ACC Literacy Building, which would transfer $281,915.58 to the Capital Reserve Fund. For our school's capital project, we would transfer $7.4 million from the capital to the capital project fund for the reimbursement resolution. We would reduce the budget by 27 cents and $4,936.86 to close out past projects at Alexander Wilson Elementary and Woodlawn Middle Schools. We would budget $46,000 that would be transferred from the school's capital reserve fund to close out past projects, and to transfer $1,459,068 to the general fund for the lottery proceeds that are used for debt services. As the board will recall, that is an approved MOU between the Board of Education and the County Commissioners. And then our last two more, and then this one will be done, we will transfer $44,884.57 to the County Building Capital Reserve Fund that will close out the 800 megahertz emergency communication project fund. And for landfill, we would budget $250,000 for expected auditor entries.
That's a lot to think about.
Yes, sir, it is.
You get all that, dude.
I try. I
think I got it. I've got it. There was a bill approved last week. A Viper, I think they call it the Viper bill. I've forgotten the number on it. That allocates funds across the state for communications. Viper improvements. Does that in any way help us with the situation in the North Alamance communication tower?
So the tower that we're currently working on is VHF to help the fire departments and EMS with their pager units. But, you know, we kind of got derailed by the coronavirus from our CCOM project. We had started, Bruce had been working with Viper and the state and Tron to map our current level of coverage, because we had issues with some particular grant. So we have those maps, and we got the maps, and we started making plans about going out and going to the spots that we could see had some lacking coverage, and COVID hit, and we've just kind of been derailed. But we haven't forgot it. In fact, I've talked to Bruce several times, even during this crisis, to say we've got to get back on this. We can see that there would be value in having some additional Viper towers in the county. So if there's a way to find funding maybe from the state, that could, they would benefit from the Viper network being strong here too, since they use it for pilot patrol. So we will certainly look into, is there any funds allocated for that? We just kind of got off track a little bit as we got into the virus. So.
But it doesn't impact the tower we were talking about?
Not the one out in the Five Points area. That's a VHF tower.
I'll make the motion that we approve all that you
said. And I'll second that, Bill.
Okay, we have a motion by Mr. Lashley and a second by Mr. Boswell. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
Before you go, Susan, let me ask you this.
Sir.
I've asked this in the past, and it was answered, but I don't remember the answer. And I can only cite 1 year as my concern as far as what the deal may be here. You know, when Honeycutt was our manager, he put out there that we were going to be $800,000. I think it was back when we got the letter from the state that, you know, we were going below 8% or whatever, and that at the end of the year, we were due to, you know, there was carryover. In other words, you got some money coming in after the fiscal year was over with.
Right.
Okay. And it was, the projection was $800,000. Okay. And then it came in at almost $4 million. And what are we anticipating here? And if you could give me a brief definition or explanation as to, for instance, that particular year. We've talked about this. I just don't remember the answer, but I want to leave this budget here, budget vote, with this final remembrance of that particular issue. Why, you know, we said 800,000 and it turned out to be about 4 million. I mean, can you explain what happened that particular year and what are we forecasting for this upcoming?
So as best as I can recall from that, and I'll have to go back to my notes to give a true representation of exactly what happened. But if memory serves me correct, there were some additional revenues that we received through that accrual period. There was an increase in sales tax as well as property tax that was collected. So that's where we saw the increase that drove it from, as Mr. Honeycutt had stated, 800,000 to putting about $4 million into our fund balance. When you get into the local government commission, what they look at is having available fund balance of greater than 8%. Because if we were to not collect any revenues, we would still have a county government to run. And 8% is basically 1 month's allocation. So when you get into having only 1 month's allocation available, it raises a concern to the LGC, because North Carolina prides itself with having the LGC to help county governments as well as municipal governments make sure that we are being good stewards of the county's money, and to also make sure that we are not working to, as some states actually operate, at a negative deficit within our government.
Forgive me. I understand that.
Mm-hmm.
But my question is, you know, and I don't think Honeycutt's scenario then was, you know, predicting 8% or whatever. Yeah, he said 800,000 was about all we want to have go over the fiscal year, okay? The settlement, whatever, how that's defined. And it came in at 4 million. And my question is what are we thinking that might happen at the end of this fiscal year as a settlement, more or less, when all the dust settles, versus, and again, the definition of why we got 400 versus 800. That's what I'm asking. I'm not asking about 8%. I understand that.
Okay. Let me do some more research on that, because just off the cuff, without going back through and looking at my notes to give you a final answer on that, Mr. Sutton, let me get that to the board tomorrow. I can find out exactly where. But we'll find out exactly where. And as far as where we're going to wind up fiscal year this year, we know that we will add to fund balance. What that amount will be right now, we don't know. A lot of that is dependent upon how sales tax is going to continue to come in for the next couple of months, as well as our property tax and other departmental revenues that COVID-19 has had a dramatic effect on. But as soon as I have any information that we can share with the board, we will.
Great. Thank you.
Right. Thank you.
The next item on our agenda is the public speakers who wanted to be heard on non-agenda related items. Bless your hearts. I've been here a long time. So you each get 3 minutes apiece for the public hearing on the budget. People got 5 minutes. But for the regular public speakers, you get 3 minutes per person. It's a total of 30 minutes for the public speaker time. So, Mr. Tim Lee, would you like to come back up?
I waited 3 hours to get 3 minutes.
You waited 3 hours to get almost 3.5 hours.
That's okay.
Thank you.
Well, good evening. My name's Tim Woody, and I live at 6850 Flyway Run in Alamance County. And I too want to thank each and every one of you for your service. And I, like Board Chair Kaylee, I feel compelled to come tonight before you to make a stand. I, like many people, watch the commission meetings remotely. And I recently viewed the May 18th commission meeting where Commissioner Lashley discussed bears and sheriff cars to protect deputies from arrestees. Mr. Lashley reported that we cannot do now what we used to do when he was on. We used to beat the hell out of them. These comments were followed by laughter from some commissioners and perplexed looks from the audience. Folks, I'm a recent retiree after 32 years of public service from state, county, and municipal government, and a proud recipient of the state's Order of the Longleaf Pine. I'm here to say if I'd made such a comment as this during my career, I would have been terminated. I cannot believe anyone finds this acceptable or amusing in its actions like these that have brought us to where we are now. I'm sure using force to arrest individuals is sometimes part of the job. However, those arrestees are still human beings. Often, they are victims of mental illness or substance abuse. If an officer is required to resort to physical tactics, I would hope that they would be professional and humane. Beating the hell out of somebody or another human and boasting about it later is neither. One newspaper report quoted Board Chair Gailey as wanting to do better regarding her comments and her response to the comment. It was also reported that Mr. Lashley was given an opportunity to rephrase, however he chose to get tough and do something about it. I was even more saddened to hear Commissioner Sutton condone these comments. He was quoted in that same newspaper article as saying, we've got to start maintaining the morals of this nation and realize that we have them and do what we have to do to enforce them. Surely you're not saying that our national morals support beating the hell out of somebody. I was encouraged to hear Commissioner Carter offer an apology for any offensive words or actions on his part. Thank you. I will say that actions and rhetoric like this do not represent me. In fact, it's embarrassing. Many of us fall into the traps of misspeaking, putting our foot into our mouths, or verbal blunders. I truly hope that this is the case in this situation, and if so, constituents are owed an apology. If this is not the case, then Mr. Lashley, you feel that beating the hell out of the arrestees is okay, I feel you should resign from this board immediately. Thank you.
Can I comment about that?
Would you mind waiting until the end of the period?
I wouldn't mind.
Because these people have been waiting for the whole meeting to have their chance. And there may be some money. So, is Caleb Wood is here.
Again, thank you, commissioners, for taking the time to wait for me tonight. My name is Caleb Woody, and I live at 6850 Flyway Run in Burlington, North Carolina. I was born and raised in North Carolina, and I raised with an appreciation for hard work, perseverance, and self-reliance, many of the values I consider integral to our culture and of our community. I take pride in the farm that I built with my parents, two dedicated public servants, one of whom was awarded the Order of the Longleaf Pine. The parents who taught me how to tell when it's time to plant tomatoes and how to cook bread from scratch are the same ones who encourage me to advocate for justice, speak against inequity, and fight for truth, even when standing alone, and that's what I hope to do today. Let's consider the slogan for Alamance County. If you forget, it's on your name tents right there. Pro bono publico, meaning for the public good. Or perhaps Mebane's slogan, a progressive city in motion. Or Graham's, a city designed for living. All of these phrases aspire to the lofty ideal that our communities are welcome, are welcoming, ahead of the curve, and ready to embrace challenges as we meet them. And I hope that's the case as we face this issue I bring before you tonight. In 1914, nearly 50 years following the end of the Civil War, the United Daughters of the Confederacy dedicated a memorial on the grounds of this very courthouse in a misguided attempt to blur the historical record. The UDC, an organization who has lauded the Ku Klux Klan and has funded other memorials in their honor in this very state, says its goals on their website include the collection and preservation of the material for a truthful history of the war between the states. But this monument serves to do the opposite. The Grand Confederate Memorial and others like it serve to paint the ideals and values of this Confederacy in a more positive light than historical fact would suggest. This memorial was and is a single part of a larger national effort to alter the historical record, replacing historical fact with the myth of the lost cause. Let's look at some material that can be used to garner a more truthful history of the Civil War, as the UDC claims to do. In 1861, Alex Stevens, the Vice President of the Confederate States, stated that our new government's foundations are laid. Its cornerstone rests upon the great truth that the Negro is not equal to the white man. This monument was erected to honor those who fought to preserve the Confederacy, an organization whose government was formed on the cornerstone of racist inequality. This monument was intended to further perpetuate the system of white supremacy. This monument is dedicated to those who fought for a cause that in the cruelest fashion devalued human life. The first slave ship came to our shores in 1619, and for 246 years, legal slavery persisted. Since the 13th Amendment ratified in 1866, black citizens have continued to fight against legal discrimination and prejudice until 1964 and 65 with the passing of the Civil Rights Acts. Even still, black citizens face valid discrimination in our society today. The monument was here in 1914, but now in 2020, you have a chance to set the record right and make sure Alamance County is forever on the right side of history. I ask you to consider the removal of this monument. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Woody. Is Butch McKenzie here?
Yes.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm here to complain about the noise ordinance by the 1776 Shooting Club out on Fawcett Lane and Jim Barnwell Road. I've called the Sheriff's Department several times, and they say their hands are tied. They always say that the lieutenant says they can't do anything. The ordinance says sounds associated with the customary to industrial and manufacturing operations is exempt. I don't think a gun club is industrial or manufacturing. Also, I've talked to several of my neighbors. They say things like they're sick of the noise, they're tired of ducking when they go outside their house, they're very upset, their dog is nervous all the time, they're sick of the noise, they're tired of the noise, it's been obnoxious this week, and they hate it. I ask you, I want the noise ordinance enforced. It's not worth living like this. You can't take naps. You can't go outside your house. My house shakes. It sounds like a cannon's going off. It's just an awful experience to go through. So it sounds like you're living in a war zone. I have a rough draft of a petition, and my neighbors are willing to sign this petition. I don't know if I should read it to you. I probably don't have time. But if I need to, I'll get all the neighbors in the neighborhood to sign the petition to limit or get you to revoke the permit for them to have a gun club in our neighborhood. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McKenzie. Mr. Walter Allison.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I'm here to comment on a statement made by our commissioner of Alamance County. As in your prayer, you said a country divided. When a commissioner in an open meeting heard by the public after the murder of George Floyd says, "When I was a cop, we would just beat the hell out of them." In Alamance County, people of color are appalled by this statement. Since it was done in an open meeting, an apology to people of color would be very appreciated in an open meeting. Also, it's time each of you to be more sensitive to racial divisions in Alamance County. Not either one of you has taken a racial equity class, nor have I personally seen any of you at any events that are held to promote racial equity. Again, I ask for an apology in an open meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Allison. Is Gwen McKenzie here? And Angela Freeman?
Yes, my name is Angela Freeman, and I live in Bremerton, and I own a car, and it's called Moonshine. I have worked my butt off trying to keep this bar rolling. It's my first business I've ever owned. I have a family. I cannot support my family with my bar being closed. The county bars are open. The Bremerton police will not let me open my bar. He told me he would have me arrested, he would take my liquor license, and I'm never getting them back. Something needs to be done. I am done with this governor. Period. And with the SBA loans they are offering to these small businesses, you have to have perfect credit. Everybody don't have perfect credit. And if you don't have credit, you can't get it. And I know a bunch of friends of mine that cannot get it, and they are not going to be able to open. And they're just like me. They just opened the doors. Something needs to be done. I mean, I've done, you know, there's other bars that's open in Burlington. Nothing's been done to them. But you open your doors, you get shut down. What's that tell you? I'm a woman, rest of them a man, bars that has not been shut down. I feel like I'm being discriminated. And that's all I have to say. Thank y'all.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you for coming out, Ms. Freeman, and thank you for waiting through this long meeting for that. Do you have anybody on your list who is here? Because you have a different list than I do. Is there anybody here who signed up to speak at the end of the meeting who I did not call your name? Who you wrote your name down in the paper? So I want to make sure everybody's taken care of. Now, I think we do have a couple of email public comments for the end of the meeting. So go ahead, Clark, you would get those. How many are there?
Just two.
Okay.
The first one's from Adam Rose. I have lived in Alamance County all of my life, excluding various deployments with the National Guard. I have always been proud to call Alamance County my home, and I hope to continue to be able to say that in the future. Much criticism is being given to our governor and various other officials regarding the COVID-19 pandemic. If that criticism is warranted or not, is not why I am here today. I want to ask a few questions that hopefully will lead to some introspect and thinking. Did we encourage our community to practice the recommended guidelines by supporting those measures and setting a good example? Looking at a photo from April 22nd on the Alamance County Facebook page at the unfortunate disaster of the tornado, I see three of our elected officials standing in close proximity to each other, not wearing any face covering, despite some of them having posted just prior to that of making a face mask. In April, we had our first COVID-related death, unfortunately. From there, things began escalating. Everything was going up from case counts to relentlessness to tensions within the county. To quote an article recently shared by one of the commissioners, where North Carolinians sheltering at home temporarily meant at most a few weeks. They started moving around more. Some returned to their workplaces. Again, people were voting with their feet before Cooper initiated his phase one in early May. Naturally, as more businesses could legally reopen, the trend intensified. By May 20th, foot traffic was at 30% below normal. It is now 20% below normal and will likely continue to improve. This article was shared in opposition to Governor Cooper's handling of the pandemic and possibly of reversing phases, but when it's within itself, it pointed out the reason that the guidelines were becoming ineffective and our case counts were increasing. I would ask you if looking at how our county was handling the guidelines during that time, if we really did all that we could to support the guidelines and make the stay-at-home order effective. Have we truly been supporting those officials elected over us in not just our words and statements, but in our actions as well? When citizens are told by a higher elected official to practice certain behaviors, then they see other elected officials not practicing those behaviors. It creates confusion and begins subverting the effects of those higher elected officials. Instead of having local leaders showing a unifying message, that confusion began manifesting itself within the county. Later, that confusion began to display publicly with the officials bickering over the governor's orders, their legality, and enforcement. I won't comment on an ongoing legal matter as the rules forbid it, but it was easy to see that we did not have a unified team of elected officials as they were using local media to argue instead of effectively communicating with each other. If any of you have ever served in the military or know anyone that has, they can stress to you the dangers that come about when lower ranks sense or hear that their superiors don't agree with the orders of their hires. It creates dissension and ultimately can lead to mutiny or insubordination. You may hear military members say such things as lead from the front, which means to lead by example, or you don't have to respect the person, but respect the rank. That's a reminder that regardless of your personal opinions, you still respect the lawful orders of those appointed over you. I beg of you, please step back, consider the recent events and how they were handled. Could they have been handled differently? And were we presenting a unified front to show solidarity and encourage the best from everyone in the county? Were we making decisions based on what's best for our county, or based on campaign contributions, popularity, or what would be the easy road? This road that we are currently on isn't headed to a happy place, and I sincerely hope that for everyone's sake, we can still take an exit to a better route. Our county has not very pleasant history with our governors, looking back at our past to the Kirk Colden War and the events surrounding it. We're not headed to a cheery place if we don't stop and consider the effects of our actions and decisions. And the last one was submitted by Michael Graves of Burlington. At a recent board of commissioners meeting, one of the commissioners made an appalling and shocking statement concerning what he used to do as a former police officer and beating up people that he arrested. Those comments would be shocking at any day and time in a civilized society. But being that this country and us are trained on police brutality makes it even more irresponsible from a so-called leader. Those comments put the coffers of this county in jeopardy, because if any deputy believes that type of action is concerned by leadership and takes it upon themselves to act in that irresponsible manner, the county will face the legal consequences. Only a person who has a dark heart and archaic mind would believe that that type of action from a law enforcement official is okay. I thank God that we have a sheriff and an administration that would not condone that. And I believe that message has been strong narrated to all deputies. I am not shocked when a dog scratches himself or a bird flies, or when the Dallas Cowboys don't make the playoffs. And when certain commissioners will make certain statements, that is not accepted by intelligent or civilized people. What has shocked me is that no commissioner pushed back against the statement and simply said, that may be how you done things back in 1950, but that is not the way a civilized law enforcement agency does things in 2020. And more importantly, that is not the way the Alamance County Sheriff's Department do things. We all have a role to play in calming things down in our society. And those comments were not only ignorant, but they were inflammatory and could cause more damage to our community than could be expected. I would hope that all commissioners and county management will realize that those comments were not acceptable and should not be condoned or laughed at. There were certain things that were acceptable, and that some commissioners' time that are no longer acceptable today. And I'm sure, much to his chagrin, but this is a new day. I hope all the generations that may have been taught by the commissioner, but if they get on this board, they should realize if they want to stay on this board, they need to reject those teachings. There are certain things in society that are archaic, like statues and Confederate flags and commissioners who believe their first name is Jim and last name is. But just like those things that were acceptable in the past, their time will come to a peaceful, legal manner, and so will those thoughts and beliefs or of that commissioner as well as that commissioner. And that's the time to say.
All right, thank you. So we have an opportunity for commissioner responses. Mr. McKenzie, before we go on to others, you mentioned about the noise ordinance.
Yes.
Here you are. Mr. Albright, help me. We spent a good bit of time last year talking about the noise ordinance as it relates to gunfire in the county. Am I correct in remembering that there's a state statute that says that we are not allowed to use a noise ordinance to regulate shooting ranges?
I have returned Mr. McKenzie's email. He's a friend of mine. I hadn't heard from him since he fixed my car 10 years ago. But anyway, I promised to get back to him. And I did mention to him that there are some statutory roadblocks and some case law roadblocks. I'd be happy to talk to him about it.
Yeah. Existing gun ranges are protected under state law GS-14-409.46, which grandfathers all established before September.
Mr. McKenzie, I'm going to interrupt you. I'm sorry. I need to clarify that this is not an opportunity for us to have this session here. We're going to let you get back with Mr. Albright and talk about that.
I've got his contact information. I'll call.
So we're not going to engage in the conversation with the audience member at this time.
Okay.
So, Mr. Lashley, did you have some comments you wanted to
make? Yes, I do. Let me say that I want to apologize for making that statement. 50 years ago, you didn't have people that took everything and turned it into race. The things that I said, the things that I did 50 years ago can be done today, thank God. But that Burlington reporter stated it as if I had said that statement. Since the man was killed with the police officer's foot on his neck, I thought that was the worst thing I've ever seen. And that kind of stuff cannot go on and does not need to go on. But what has to be said is the police officers have got a job to do, and that's what they do. When you call a police officer, he reacts to what the person that's committed the crime acts. And I'm not going to let that situation happen. If somebody tries to bother me, they're going to have a problem, even today. I try to treat everybody fair, but by God, they're going to treat me fair too. And the problem is not with what I said. The problem is with that Brockton reporter. He's trying to stir up a bunch of stuff. And he's going to answer, if anything happens to me and my family, he's going to pay the price. You can bet on it.
My turn.
Sure.
Yeah. Mr. Wood, you made a statement there. What was your source for understanding what I said? I'm not talking about Mr. Lash at all. Did you say that it seemed like I said, or what was your source? Mr. Wood.
Yeah, my question is, we're going to have this conversation now? Or?
Yes, sir.
Sure. The paper, same article that I quoted from?
The paper.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what I said in the paper.
Okay. Well, that's what I want to clarify that.
Yeah.
I know what my statements were, and I know what the intent was. I even complained to a newspaper that they left out key points.
Here's your chance.
I don't need another chance. I'm just going to tell you that you're wrong about what you interpreted that I said.
Well, now, what'd you say?
Okay, I've heard what you said. Now it's my turn. Okay, okay. Well, just be quiet. Just let me finish, please. I made the reference that what took place was disgraceful. Made it clear. And an addendum to that, I can't watch it. It's so bad in my heart, in my mind. I made it clear that what I was commenting about was something that happened before that. Clearly. And I made the reference that in Myrtle Beach, Ory County, South Carolina, stuff was going on in the streets of the busiest commercial tourist area that I thought I would never see. Ory County, South Carolina, dear my heart. I've seen people get out of cars on, well, I didn't hit, put this in the statement, but I said they're pulling out guns and having shootouts right in the middle of the street. Gangs. And I made the reference, you're not going to, I said it would be nice to be able to talk this out. I said it two or three times. But I said, with that situation, and I still say, you're not going to sell what's going on, Ory County, South Carolina, with the gangs coming in from all over, local areas, Rockingham, Hamlet, just in the news just the other day, by passing out cupcakes on the corner. And I mean that. And the reporter,
Isaac Gross.
Well, Borowski is the one that did the story that I complained about. He left out the he said it seemed like Sutton agreed with Lashley. Now, I'm not trying to make a distinction here. I'm talking about Tim Sutton. I'm constantly pigeonholed, stereotyped. I know what's in my heart. I know how I've raised my family. I know how I've raised my boys. I said what I said, and I meant it. The gang shootings in the streets at Myrtle Beach are not going to stop until they address it with force. And I believe that. I believe that with all my heart. I have seen video of tourists filming with their video cameras down on the street of the gangs coming in from Socastee and those areas down there, the adjacent communities, and they just pull up in the parking lot and pull out guns and start shooting. I've seen it. I've seen the video. That's what I said. There's a big distinction there. It's kind of like when the MPs used to walk Hay Street and Fayetteville all the time at Fort Bragg. You ain't going to do much down Hay Street back when it was rough without an MP coming in on you. I'm not ashamed of what I said, but you pigeonholed me. You took
I just quoted what was in the paper.
Well, it was wrong.
Okay, we're taking it up with the paper.
Well, I already have, and I took it up with you. Thank you.
Any other commissioners?
I'd like to correct some statements that were made earlier tonight. I heard it over and over, and I got at least 15 to 20 emails, I think, that referenced cutting law enforcement. And a number of those were obvious form letters because they referenced police departments and cities instead of the county. So they just cut and pasted and sent them to us. But I've heard people say that we don't need any more SROs. I've heard people say that SROs can't be effective. I just
can't bear the thought of being on this board at some point in time if we were to have the event that we've seen in other schools, and know that had there been an SRO in place, he or she might have been able to prevent that event. So at some point, I would love to see us have an SRO in every school in Alamance County. I know there are people who don't like law enforcement, apparently. But folks, I don't know who else you're gonna call if somebody breaks into your house. I don't think you're gonna call them. I heard a comment made this weekend. Don't call Ghostbusters, right? They're not gonna help you. If you don't call law enforcement, you're not gonna get any help.
Yeah.
If we cut law enforcement, we've already frozen positions of law enforcement in the county because of this COVID impact on our budget. If we continue to try and sustain a lower level of law enforcement, we only put our citizens at risk at some point. I think our sheriff has the respect of the entire community. At least I've seen in the event this past week. By the way, somebody said he didn't see anybody there from this group. I can tell you there were two of us that I know of that were there from this group. And spouses. We believe that we, at least I do, and I think the rest of us do too, we believe we represent every single citizen in this county. The fact that I was elected from one party doesn't make any difference to me when I'm working as a representative in this community. I represent everybody. If you want to see the amount of time I personally have spent in emails on issues that I know were already answered when you actually dug into the budget, and I've sent information out to dozens and dozens and dozens of people, and I know some of us others have as well. Another issue there is the issue of ICE and the government and the sheriff's relationship with ICE right now. That money comes in to be used for ICE. We don't get to use it in the county. That's for the sheriff's department and for their use over there. I don't know where anybody came up with the idea that we have doubled the sheriff's budget. First of all, in public safety, the number is up five one hundredths of a percent over what it was last year. It was 29.95% last year. This year it's 23%. And that doesn't just include the sheriff's office. It includes the fire marshal, it includes EMS, it includes emergency management and others. The level of misinformation in the community sometimes boggles my mind that people could not see the numbers that are out there, or they just believe what somebody has told them. And if I'm ever a part of that, I apologize. I certainly don't want to be. But folks, we are your representatives. If you need us, you call us. I don't know who else you're going to call if you live out in the county. If you live in Burlington, Graham, Mebane, or one of the other municipalities with a sheriff or the police department, your 911 call is going to go to them. But if you live in Alamance County in the rural parks, your call is going to go to the sheriff's department. And I don't know anybody that didn't see and respect the sheriff and his team at this event last week. Was it last week? Last month.
Yeah, last week.
Total support from him for the community. So, if you didn't see us, I'm sorry. We were there. And I just wish everybody would pay the same amount of attention to all of the aspects of what's going on in our community and all the support that you get, whether you realize it or not. appreciate your time and I appreciate your support. Thank you.
What do you think? Okay. Just briefly, Mr. Allison, you know, I think a lot of you, and we've had some good conversations at the farmer's market and so forth. I think that when you said that you hadn't seen us at events to promote racial equity, I don't think you were referring to the prayer vigil or things like that. I think you were maybe referring more to academic settings that the Racial Equity Alliance puts together. Mr. Carter was speaking about a prayer vigil that was hosted last week, and he and I were there. I wasn't up in the front, I was in the back. So if you were there, I thought Dr. Yarbrough was going to be there. One of the reasons I went is because I thought you were going to be there.
I was there.
You were there?
She was right in front.
I didn't see you, so you must have been in the very front and I was in the very back. I've heard you were going to be there and I was looking forward to seeing you. And Mr. Allison, you were saying, you know, that you know, we should be more sensitive to the racial division in the country and that we haven't been in events to promote the racial equity. I just want to respond to that because you're right, I've not been to the Racial Alliance events, but I am on a journey. I have attended other things, and I was thinking about what to say about that. Because it's complex when you're a public person, you have a public, you know, people expect to know things about you publicly, and there's a certain amount of accountability as an elected official. But at the same time, when I do things because, you know, I do them because I'm interested in them or because I want to learn, don't necessarily want to turn around and call attention to it. That doesn't feel authentic to me. But I'll give you an example. And I hope that Mr. Hager won't mind me saying this. I'm talking about, we went to Washington, D.C. last year for Alamance Achieves. Sent a group of board members to Washington, D.C. to participate in a conference. And we had some downtime. And Mr. Hager and I said, what you feel like doing? And the African-American Museum was right there. And so we decided to go check it out because we're interested. And so we did. And one of the things that really struck me was that we were two of the only white people in the entire place. And I had the opportunity to observe the expression on the faces and the observing from my perspective the engagement of the African Americans going through the museum. So just because you don't see me or Mr. Haywood or another anybody, you don't see us at the racial equity or the racial alliance things, please don't think that we don't care or we're not engaged, because we're all on our own journeys. And you know, I care deeply about the whole community and the people of color in the community. And as I said at our last meeting, I'm working on, you know, I didn't say I will try to do better. I said I will do better. I'm not trying, I am doing. And, but I'm not going to go around talking about it a lot because it's private. And that's part of the reason, I'll just be really honest right now, that's part of the reason that I haven't been to the Racial Alliance things is because as a Republican and a woman elected official in Alamance County, I feel like I'd be watched. Like the people who were there attending the racial equity things would be watching me and judging me for what I do say and judging me for what I don't say. So instead of pursuing those things, I prefer to do things privately in my own way and to seek out those books, those educational experiences that come my way that I pay attention to and take advantage of when I can. So I hope that and I
delighted to talk with you about that privately. And Dr. Yarborough and Barrett Brown and other people, Michael Graves, other people in our community. I'm delighted to have those conversations when we can and when it's appropriate. So I think that I will, there are other remarks that were made tonight that I could spend some time talking about, but I think the meeting has been long enough and we don't have to pick apart every meeting and drive it into the ground. So does anybody else have any responses? Mr. Haygood, do you have a county manager's report?
Only an announcement that I learned from Johnny Payne, fire marshal today, that Mike Halsey, insurance commissioner, will be in town next Thursday at the Carver's restaurant at 11:30, and I believe it's an open invitation for anybody who wants to stop by and see the commissioner and visit with him. We appreciate the fact that he comes to Alamance County quite often and visits. So next Thursday, 11:30, Carver's, Mike Halsey.
Great. Well, we'll try to make that. Do we have any commissioner comments tonight?
I want to thank Brian for the job he did on our budget this year.
Thank you for
saying that. It was challenging, and you did a great job, Brian.
Amen. Well, a lot of help, Andrea and Susan, and a lot of other folks, department heads, too, not a budget that if you would have asked me in January, I'd had any idea we'd be working on. But
it's been a whole new world, hasn't it?
What a year.
Absolutely. And I want to take the opportunity, Ray is still up there, Ray Rickerman, and the team at the EMS. I just want to take the opportunity to thank y'all. And I'm glad we're able to do the hazard pay for the full-time and the part-time employees, and also for the health department and for CCOM and the fire marshal's office. There's Sean Payne back there. And Adrian Day from DSS is up there. We had the opportunity to do some things for some DSS workers as well. So we just really appreciate y'all. But it's, and we love all the employees at the EMS. Y'all have earned a special place in my heart, that's for sure. All the stuff that that department has been through since the first of the year has been, or even before that, has been really, it's been a real load on y'all. And I'm glad that the county was able to recognize that sacrifice and service from them.
Thank you.
So, anybody else have anything to say? All right, well, it is 5 after 11, and we'll be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.